Section 256 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Accuse Not the Servant. Read for LibriVox.org by Hannah Dowell. As the possibilities of rapid advancement were redoubled during the war, the President, in his first term of office, was stormed by the office seekers, who thought it the best plan to have occupiers of posts outed to give them an opening. So they maligned and even accused chief officials with a freedom unknown in other countries where the bureaucracy is a sacred institution, as, within a generation, it has become here. Lincoln rebuked one of those covetous vexers by saying gravely to him, "Friend, go home and attentively read Proverbs, chapter 13, verse 10. The rebuffed applicant found at that page in the book, "Accuse not a servant to his master, lest he curse thee, and thou be found guilty." Attested by Shiloh Colflax. End of section 256. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 257 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. A Wolf in a Trap Must Sacrifice His Tail to Be Free. Read for LibriVox.org by Captain Allegra. The Presidential Private Secretary, Stoddard, maintains that his chief sorely astonished and baffled the tribe of acquaintances who flocked in upon him as soon as he was elevated, and went back home with empty haversacks, wondering that he ignored them with heartless ingratitude. He did not make even his own father a brigadier, nor invite Cousin Dennis Hanks to a seat in his cabinet. End of section 257. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 258 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Somewhat of a Newsman. Read for LibriVox.org by Todd Lennon. Innately attached to letters and precocious, Abraham Lincoln soon learned his letters and drank in all the learning that his few books could supply. Hence, at an early age, he became the oracle on the rude frontier, where even a smattering made him handy and valuable to the illiterate backwoodsman. Besides, as working in any place and at any work, he rarely abided long in any one spot, and had not what might be called a home in his teens. Dennis Hanks, his cousin, said of Abraham, at 14 to 18, "Abe was a good talker, a good reader, and a kind of newsboy. Hence he was a sort of volunteer colporter, distributing gossip, as a notion peddler, before he was a store clerk where centered all the local news. It was on this experience that he would mingle with the newspaper reporters and telegraph men fraternally, saying with his winning smile and undeniable push, 'Let me in, boys, for I am somewhat of a news-gatherer myself.' And then he would fix his footing by one of his stories, always, well often, uttered with a view to publication." End of section 258. This recording is in the public domain. Recorded by Todd Lennon, Albuquerque, New Mexico, January 4, 2009.
Section 259 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. A Little More Light and a Little Less Noise. Read for LibriVox.org. As the President was a diligent devourer of the newspaper in the vexatious times, as at all others, he met many a torrent of criticism, incitement, and counsels, which left him stunned rather than alleviated. To a special correspondent who hampered him, he said, "Your papers remind me of a little story. There was a gentleman traveling on horseback in the West, where the roads were few and bad and no settlements. He lost his way. To make matters worse, as night came on, a terrible thunderstorm arose. Lightning dazzled the eye, or thunder shook the earth. Frightened, he got off and led his horse, seeking to guide himself by the spasmodic and flickering electric light. All of a sudden, a tremendous crash brought the man in terror to his knees, when he stammered, 'O Lord, if it be the same to thee, give us a little more light and a little less noise.'" End of section 259. This recording is in the public domain.
Section
Section 260 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. My part of the ship is anchored. Among the first men called out was a young Massachusetts man, Burridge, who went as a private. Grievously wounded, he was sent into the hospital and then to his home. Recuperated, he joined his old regiment at the front. He was unaware that strict orders were out against the soldiers exchanging newspapers, and so performed the daily courtesy of giving a paper to the rebels. They had two, and he promised to give them the one due next time. This was held as keeping up correspondence with the Johnnies, and the authorities reduced him to the ranks, as he was then a captain. Worse and worse, the enemy seized him when he went out to redeem his promise about the news, and he was imprisoned on their side. This regalled his wounds, and he was a great sufferer. The Massachusetts member of Congress, Alexander Rice, pleaded with the President for his native citizen. The complication was that Burridge was a captain when captured, but a private again soon after, and the rebels would probably hold him at the higher rate if an exchange was allowed, while the Union War Department stood for his being but a common soldier. "If General Wadsworth raises that point," replied the President, who had allowed this pathetic case to break his rule to deal with classes and not individual offenses, "tell him if he could take care of the exchange part, I guess I can take care of the rank part." It is clear that the President saw in this punctilio about a humane act whose offense was rancor. It reminded one of the story of the New England skipper who, with his mate and crew of a small fisher, owned the vessel. They having quarreled, and the captain bidding the other mind his part of the ship, the latter did so, and presently came to the stern to report, "Captain, I have anchored my part of the ship. Take care of your own." End of Section 260. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 261 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Angels Swearing Make No Difference. Read for LibriVox.org by Rick Rodstrom. On the President being urged to answer some virulent newspaper assault, his reply was, "Oh, no, if I were to try to read, much less answer, all the attacks made on me, this shop might as well be closed for any other business. I do the very best I know how, the very best I can, and I mean to keep doing so until the end. If the end brings me out all right, what is said against me won't amount to anything. If the end brings me out wrong, 10 angels swearing I was right would make no difference." End of Section 261. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 262 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Washington's Difficult Task. Read for LibriVox.org. Shortly after Lincoln's inauguration, a senator said to him, "You have as difficult a task as Washington's, when he took command of the American army, and as little to do with it." "That is true, but I have larger resources." The 3,000 millions spent on the war vividly contrast with the colonies fighting rich England with an empty treasury and barefoot, ragged soldiers. End of Section 262. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 263 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Steel and Steel. Read for LibriVox.org by Rebecca Case. President Lincoln asked a friend, a senator, immediately on his taking office, upon an embarrassed condition of affairs, "Have you seen that prophecy about my administration in the papers? A prophet foretells that my rule will be one of steel." To which the wags retort, "Well, Buchanan's was one of steel." The Georgian slaveholder, late Secretary of the Treasury, was accused of diverting some millions to the South, as if for the War Office similarly diverted ordnance and munitions to the same quarter. The head of the Navy, with what looked like collusion, had scattered the war vessels so as to be long delayed in concentrating.
End of Section 263. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 264 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. That's What's the Matter. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. That's What's the Matter. In a spiritualist performance at the White House, which seemed to have been edited by the President himself, as often royalty revises plays, for his special entertainment, the Cabinet being invited, after a rigmarole of stilted phrases purporting to be by Washington, Franklin, Napoleon, and other past celebrities, Mr. Wells, Secretary of the Navy, remarked, "I will think this matter over and see what conclusion to arrive at." This was his set phrase. There was a smile at this, as the aged minister's prolonged meditations were the laughing stock of the country, he being the clog on the wheels of the car of state. Instantly raps were heard in the spirit cabinet, and the alphabet being consulted, the result was spelled out as, "That's What's the Matter." This hit at Mr. Wells' stereotyped fault aroused more mirth, and the crowd at the back of the room, domestics, petty officials, and sub-officers laughed prodigiously, while the secretary stroked his long white beard musingly. To this cant term hangs a tale, propos of the President. Its origin was low, but humorous. A benevolent gentleman pierced a crowd to its centre to see there, on the pavement under a lamppost, a poor woman curled in a heap, with a satisfied grin on her flushed face, breathing brokenly. "What's the matter?" eagerly inquired the compassionate man. A bystander removed his pipe from his mouth, and with it pointed to a flattened pocket flask sticking out of her smashed reticule, half under her, and sententiously explained, "That's what's the matter with Hannah." The sentence took growth and spread all over the Union. It has settled down, as we know, to a fixed form at political meetings, where the audience beguiled the waiting time with demanding, "What is the matter?" with this or that favourite demagogue. In the 60s, it patly answered any problem. At the presidential election time of Lincoln's success, a Negro minstrel, Unsworth, was the star at 444 Broadway, dressing up the Daily News drolly under his title, that is, ending each paragraph with that line. On the 22nd of February 1861, Abraham Lincoln scheduled to pass on from Harrisburg, where he had made a speech as arranged, instead of waiting to depart by the morning train, sped to Philadelphia, and thence by a special train, detained for a military messenger with a parcel, to Washington by the regular midnight train. The news of his arrival at the capital by this unexpected and clandestine route, and in disguise, this was denied, of a Scotch cap and plaid shawl, startled everybody. Rumours of an attempt to make mischief, as he called it, were rife. But the public still took things as quake-proof, and Mr. Lincoln assured his audiences, as he spoke at every city on his way, that the crisis was artificial. On the evening of the 23rd, the writer dropped into the Broadway Negro Minstrel Hall. Newspaper men knew that Unsworth introduced the latest skimming of the press into his burlesque lecture, and liked to hear his funny versions and perversions. The comic sheet of the Metropolis, Vanity Fair, enframing the witty scintillations of Artemus Ward, George Arnold, and a brilliant band, complained that this nigger comedian used or anticipated their best effusions. On the whole, the public saw in the surreptitious flight of the ruler into his due seat only a farce, in keeping with his jesting humour. He was regarded as Don Quixote, in figure, but a Sancho Panza for his philosophical proverbs, widely retailed and considered opportune. So the indignation proper toward the forced escapade was absent. Everybody still mocked at the terrible plots, as so much stale quail. And when the blackened-faced orator, coming to a pause after enunciation of his, "That's what's the matter," looked around wistfully, the audience were agog. Suddenly, out of the wing, an attendant darted with an alarmed manner and face. He carried on his arm a shawl, grey and travel-stained, and in one shaking hand a Scotch bonnet. Unsworth snatched them in hot haste and fright, clapped on the cap, and, draping himself in the plaid, rushed off at the side, forgetting his own high silk hat. This was the black suit. The orthodox lecturers now gave him a resemblance to Mr. Lincoln, not previously perceived, for they were men of opposite shapes, The eclipse brought home to the spectators the ludicrousness of the President entering his capital in secret. But, I repeat, no one felt any shame, and the audience went forth to relate the excellent finish to the parade, at home or in the saloons, to hearers as obtuse as themselves, to the seriousness of the episode. Somehow, so far, the elect from Illinois was ever the Western buffoon, but when in his inaugural address Lincoln thundered the new keynote, the veil fell. In your hands, my dissatisfied fellow countrymen, is the momentous issue of the Civil War. War? The crisis was no longer artificial. He admitted that. What impended? What had fallen? Jest and earnest were still coupled, but earnest took the lead from that hour. So the chief magistrate, in his first official speech, physically speaking, we cannot separate. That's what's the matter. End of section 264. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 265 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, The Ship of State Simile. On the morning of Lincoln's arrival in Washington, General Logan and Mr. Lovejoy called on him at Willard's Hotel to urge a firm and vigorous policy. He replied, "As the country has placed me at the helm of the ship, I'll try to steer her through." The Sagamon River pilot spoke there. "I understand the ship to be made for the carrying and preservation of the cargo, and so long as the ship can be saved with the cargo, it should never be abandoned, unless it fails in the probability of its preservation, and shall cease to exist, except at the risk of throwing overboard both freight and passengers." Speech, New York Reception, 1861. "I trust that I may have the assistance of the members of this legislature in piloting the ship of state through this voyage, surrounded by perils as it is, for if it should suffer shipwreck now, there will be no pilot ever needed for another voyage." Speech, Trenton, New Jersey, 1861. End of section 265. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 266 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, Appeal for the Public Printer, read for LibriVox.org. In Lincoln's first message to Congress, Special Session, July 4, 1861, is seen this passage: "With rebellion thus sugar-coated, they have been drugging the public mind," etc. Mr. DeFries, public printer, with the proofreader's sublime spurning of plain speech, objected to this sweet word, and said, "Mr. President, you are using an undignified expression. I would alter the construction if I were you." "DeFries," was the crushing reply, "that word expresses precisely my idea, and I am not going to change it. The time will never come in this country when the people won't know exactly what sugar-coated means." "I jinx. I can beat you both." One day, the public printer wanted to correct a Lincolnism in one of the presidential documents. "Go home, DeFries, and see if you can better it." The next day, DeFries took him his amendment. It happened that Secretary Seward had spied the same fault as the printer, and Lincoln confronted the two improvements. "I jinx, by jingo. Seward has been rewriting the same paragraph. I believe that you have beat Seward, but I think I can beat you both." And he wrote, with his firm hand, "Stet, so let it stand," on the proof sheet. End of section 266. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 267 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, Let the Grass Grow Where It May, read for LibriVox.org by Kidder. Up to the dread day when the news of the flag of our Union being fired upon in Charleston Harbor, the country resembled the sea in one of those calms preceding a storm, when the placidity betrays hidden in mighty currents, and overhead in the clear sky one divines the coursers of the tempest gathering to race and strife like that beneath. Up to Lincoln's arrival in Washington, the nest of sedition, the pro-slavery peace-at-any-price party slackened in no efforts to retain the status quo. Or worse, a new state of the southern states branching off as suckers strike from the main stem. William E. Dodge had the courage to face the wrought-up chief magistrate, chafed with his narrow escape from the assassins of the railroad journey from Baltimore. Said Mr. Dodge, "It is for you, Mr. President, to say whether the whole nation shall be plunged into bankruptcy. The slaves were valued as property at $2,000,000,000. Whether the grass shall grow in the streets of our commercial cities. The balance of trade against the South to the manufacturing and supplying North was stupendous. "Then I say it shall not," replied Lincoln. "If it depends on me, the grass will not grow anywhere, save in the fields and meadows." Mr. Dodge persisted in his sordid and businesslike errand. "Then you will not go to war on account of slavery?" "I do not know what my acts may be in the future, beyond this. The Constitution will not be preserved and defended until it is enforced and obeyed in every part of every one of the United States. It must be so respected, obeyed, enforced, and defended. Let the grass grow where it will." End of Section 267. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 268 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Peace at Any Price Party. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. The Peace at Any Price Party. If there were a class of men who, having no choice of sides in the contest, were anxious to have only quiet and comfort for themselves while it rages, and to fall in with the victorious side at the end of it, without loss to themselves, their advice as to the mode of conducting the contest would be precisely such as his. His being Mr. Thomas Durant, who in 1862 wrote a letter on behalf of the Conservatives asking to be let alone. He speaks of no duty, apparently thinks of none, resting upon Union men. He even thinks it injurious to the Union cause that they should be restrained in trade and passage without taking sides. They are to touch neither a sail nor a pump, live merely as passengers, deadheads at that, to be carried snug and dry through the storm, and safely landed right side up. Nay, more, even a mutineer is to go untouched lest these sacred passengers receive an accidental wound. The letter was to C. Bullitt, July 28, 1862. End of Section 268. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 269 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Things were topsy-turvy aloft, too. Read for LibriVox.org. One evening, when Mr. Hall, astronomer, was working in the Naval Observatory, Washington, on the great equatorial telescope, he was startled to have his sanctum invaded by the gaunt, extenuated figure of the President. He was made welcome, of course, and the varied mechanism explained to him. As the crowning treat, he was given a peer through the celebrated instrument. It was leveled at the moon, or rather arranged to have that orb in its focus at the time. The visitor was appalled, as well as wondering at the view, and slowly withdrew by the trap-door. But when the astronomer resumed his observations and calculations, he was interrupted by the same sedate and absorbed caller. He returned, perplexed, as on glancing up at the moon with the unhindered vision, he saw it in another position to that presented in the spyglass. Mr. Hall made it clear to him, as the telescope was pointed, not at the satellite, but at its image in a mirror, he saw its reflection, and consequently the reverse of the face we observe. The President went away with the satisfaction of a man wanting every novelty demonstrated. End of Section 269. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 270 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Hitching to the Moon. Lincoln came to Washington to view the situation, and found the world all upside down, a rumpus in the nation. Topical Song, 1860. End of Section 270. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 271 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. A Red Flag to Him. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. A Red Flag to Him. A most remarkable prelude to the war was the performance through the northern states of the Chicago Zouaves. The name came from the irregular regiment in the French-Algerian service, composed of men worthy of being drummed out of the regular corps. They dressed like the Arabs in the small bolero jacket and baggy red trousers familiar since. They drilled gymnastically, not to say theatrically. Ellsworth, a clerk in the Lincoln and Herndon law office, had a martial turn, and hearing daily in that quasi-political vortex of the impending crisis, determined to be forearmed in case of the differences coming to blows. He raised, uniformed, a la Zuzu, a score of young men like himself, and proceeded to give exhibitions at home and then in the East. The writer retains a vivid memory of the odd and fantastic show, which, however, was regarded as not war, though magnificent. But Captain Ellsworth was in earnest. Mustered in with his company, he started the Zouave movement, which led to two or more regiments being formed. His being the first volunteers at the fore, he claimed the right of the reconnoitring force sent out in May against Alexandria to break up railroads held by the rebels. Seeing a rebel flag on a hotel top, he entered the building and was shot by the landlord in coming down from cutting it away. He was slain instantly, and the like fate befell the murderer, the host, from Ellsworth's guard. Apart from four men killed at Sumter and two in Baltimore riots, the Chicago Zouave was the first victim of the rebellion. But the position was regained by the secessionist, and the rebel flag replaced the removed one, to the grief of President Lincoln. He could see it from his resident, and Murat Halstead, without knowing the melancholy association of the young officer, being a familiar in his office, reports seeing him dwell with spyglass bent on the flag for hours. Elmer Ellsworth, in his last speech made to the men he was leading out to the front, proves that he imbibed Lincoln's humanity with legal precepts in the office. Show the enemy that I want to kill them with kindness. End of section 271. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 272 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Fly Away, Jack. Read for LibriVox.org by Tricia G. Fly Away, Jack. At the end of 1860, South Carolina took the lead in seceding, and in the opening of the next year, six other southern states allied themselves with her. The timid feared hasty acting would precipitate the marshalling of the waverers under the same flag. To a committee urging a pause to see how the cats would jump, the president observed, "If there be three pigeons on the fence, and you fire and kill one, how many will there be left?" The voices said, "Two." "Oh, no," he corrected, "there would be none left, for the other two, frightened by the shot, would have flown away." As a truth, the firing on Fort Sumter welded the seceders into their union, at the same time as it likewise fused the Northerners into consistency. The president said to General Veal, "We want to keep all that we have of the border states, those that have not seceded, and the portions we have occupied." End of section 272. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 273 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. His pen wanted to keep their hogs safe. Read for LibriVox.org. Just after the call for 75,000 90-day men to subdue the outbreak after Sumter was cannonaded, a deputation of loyal Virginians waited upon the President. They expounded on this levy that the fair fields of the South would be overrun by the ragamuffins of the northern cities, and the hen roosts and pig houses ravished. "But what would you have me do?" asked Lincoln, who did not then foresee his having to conduct the military movements. "Mr. President, if you would only lend us your pen a moment," meaning, of course, that he should write a line to calm the rising storm. But the other pretended to misunderstand him, saying, "Lend my pen? My pen? What would you do with that? Keep your hogs safe with that?" End of section 273. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 274 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Hurrah for You! Read for LibriVox.org by Andrew Hoots. At the Chicago reception, a little boy came into the room with his father, No doubt he had been instructed to behave with decorum in the august presence, but he no sooner saw the tall, prominent figure than he shouted, "Hurrah for Miss Lincoln!" The crowd laughed, and still the more as the object of the ovation caught up the little fellow, gave him a toss to the ceiling, and while he was in the air shouted out lustily, "Hurrah for Mr. U!" and catching him, lowered him red and panting to the floor. End of section 274. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 275 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Put Your Feet Right and Stand Firm. Giving a lift in his carriage to two ladies, to the soldiers' home, the horses were splashing and sliding after a shower in the mire, when Mr. Lincoln assisted the frightened women to alight. He set three stones for stepping stones in the mud, and assisted them to firm ground. He had cautioned them in making the passage, "All through life be sure to put your feet in the right place, and then stand firm." Looking down on his muddy boots, Lincoln, as a Westerner, always stuck to leg boots and was never seen in the effeminate Congress gaiters, by the by, he added, "I have always heard of Washington mud, and now I shall take some home as a sample." End of section 275. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 276 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Get Their Graves Ready! Read for LibriVox.org. In April 1861, a deputation of sympathizers with secession had the boldness to call on President Lincoln and demand a cessation of hostilities until convening of Congress, threatening that 75,000 Marylanders would contest the passage of troops over their soil. "I presume," quietly replied Mr. Lincoln, "that there is room enough in her soil for 75,000 graves." Peterson's Life of Lincoln. End of section 276. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 277 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Mr. Lincoln's Opinion of General McClellan. Read for LibriVox.org by Steve Eberhardt. In the first stage of the war, when the President was Commander-in-Chief of the forces by virtue of his office, he played the part of the elevated boy in the King of the Castle. Every one of his colleagues, who ought to have been his loyal supporters, until some firm stand was attained under the batteries of Richmond, civil and military, warred against him, underhandedly and happily openly. All aimed, in cabinet and on the staff, to be ruler. The understrappers of aged General Scott upheld all that concurred with warfare, set and obsolete, of the European strategists, overthrown by the great Napoleon. The principal practicer of these tactics, the summum bonum, or good thing, of the West Pointers, was General McClellan, the little Mac of his worshippers, and the little Napoleon of the dazzled crowd. He was, like Cassio, a great arithmetician, who had never set a squadron in the field, or the division of a battle new, etc., seeming utterly to ignore that the enemy was composed of men trained by their life in genteel occupations to shoot true, to ride like Comanches or revolutionary Harry Lee's light horse, used to lying outdoors under skies genial to them, and subsisting on game and corn cake, as Marion on sweet potatoes. He expected to foil such guerrillas as Jeb Stuart, Mosby, and Quantrell by earthworks, which they probably would have leaped their horse over if they wanted to reach their spoil in that way. It was in allusion to this adherence to Vauban that the President, who eyed the aspiring Hotspur as Henry V, his heir, the sixth Henry, trying on his crown, observed shrewdly when the general kept silence, "He is entrenching." End of section 277. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 278 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. A Stationary Engine. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. A Stationary Engine. Lincoln said of the much promising General McClellan, "He is an admirable engineer, but he seems to have a special talent for a stationary engine." He also cited him as a scholar and a gentleman. Nevertheless, as the education lavished on the Army of the Potomac to make it earn foreign military critics' praise at reviews was not thrown away, but made sound soldiers which in time were invaluable to General Grant. Lincoln did him justice by quaintly but earnestly saying, "I would like to borrow his arm if he has no further use for it." General Franklin heard this, but Little Mac had no design on the dictatorship, being surely a lover of the Union too. End of section 278. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 279 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Shoveling Fleas. Read for LibriVox.org. On account of the looseness and corruption attending the raising of soldiers at the first, the President, noting the difference between the number of men forwarded to General McClellan for the Army of the Potomac and the number reported arrived, said, "Sending men to that army is like shoveling fleas across a barnyard. Half of them never get there." End of section 279. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 280 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Georgia Colonel's Costume. On account of this sectional warfare, Senator Mason of Virginia announced his resolve to wear homespun and dispense with Yankee manufactures altogether. That made Lincoln laugh and say, "To carry out his idea, he ought to go barefoot. If that's the plan, they should begin at the foundation and adopt the well-known Georgian colonel's uniform, a shirt collar and a pair of spurs." In Speech, New England Tour, 1860. End of section 280. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 281 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Course Feed First. Read for LibriVox.org by Andrew Hoots. Secretary Whitney wrote, "In July 1861, I was in Washington, where I merely said to President Lincoln, 'Everything is drifting into the war, and I guess you will have to put me in the army.'" He was in the Indian service at the time. The President looked up from his work and said good-humoredly, "I'm making generals now. In a few days, I will be making quartermasters, and then I'll fix you." End of section 281. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 282 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Ain't I Glad to Get Out of the Wilderness? Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. Ain't I glad to get out of the wilderness? In the summer of 1862, just when the North was lulled to repose by the note from General McClellan's newsmongers, that the people would have a great surprise on the 4th of July. Colonel J. E. B. Stuart, Confederate cavalryist, took about 2,000 picked riders and performed a dash within the hostile lines, which achieved a worldwide admiration. It is necessary to premise that the country was inimical to the defenders of Washington, and the farmers kept secessionists clearly informed on the federal movements. Besides, the first duty of keeping Washington engrossed all the Union commanders. If by any unexpected movement the rebels occupied the capital long enough to set up their government, Europe would have recognized the Stars and Bars, and raised the blockade on the cotton ports. Washington was stupefied and terror-stricken when the news came in from the North that the rebel cavalry were cavorting within McClellan's lines. Communication was cut off with him, and the President was heard to say in the general dumbness of consternation, "There is no news from the Army of the Potomac. I do not even know that we have an army." He was himself filled with a universal alarm. His hope was that a bright morning would follow the dark hour, but his faith and belief that God would safely lead them out of the wilderness was not widely shared. The allusion was to the popular army song, taken from the Negro camp meeting repertoire, "Ain't I Glad to Get Out of the Wilderness," which a clergyman had encouragingly chanted a while before. This wilderness was metaphorically spiritual, but all applied the figure to the wilderness of Virginia, where the battles were fought. End of section 282. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 283 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. With two guns, hold off an army. Read for LibriVox.org. One Irish artilleryman was left behind, with one gun of his battery, on the wrong bank of the Potomac, when the Union army retreated before Lee. This gunner actually telegraphed direct to the President as his commander-in-chief that, "I have the whole rebel army in my front. Send me another gun, and I assure your honor that they shall not come over." This pleased the President greatly, who answered that the new Horatius was to take counsel with his officer, if he could find him. End of section 283. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 284 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Breaking Up the Little Game. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. Breaking Up the Little Game. In 1862, Washington was full of talk and no hard cider. There was the laugh of the gossips who would chatter under fire, the chaff talk of pressmen taking things farcically, and the staff talk of the officers envying one another and scheming for places. Too many were still carrying water on both shoulders, and would have welcomed a speedy reconciliation. The President heard that some of the latter voiced the petulant complaint of those weary of the gainless military movements, that the intention was to shift the two armies about till both were exhausted, and, like the peace-at-any-price men, and the still-sympathizing pro-slavery tale, a compromise could be effected and slavery saved. He summoned the parties in this public unbosoming before him. Major Turner said that Major John J. Kay, staff officer to General McClellan, was asked why the Unionists had not bagged the rebel army soon after the Battle of Sharpsburg, whereupon he replied, "That was not the game. We should tire ourselves and the rebels out. That was the only way that the Union could be preserved. Then we would come together fraternally, and slavery will be saved." Major Key did not deny the words, but stoutly maintained his loyalty. As McClellan's staff officer, he must have known his leader's policy. No confiscation, and no Emancipation Act, for McClellan hoped, like thousands of conservatives, to bring about reaction in the South. But the President sharply said with some of his sempiternal humour, "Gentlemen, if there is a game even among Union men to have our army not take any advantage of the enemy it can, it is my object to break up that game." End of section 284. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 285 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Bottom Will Fall Out. General McClellan's delayed advance being, in 1862, not upon Manassas, but upon Yorktown, filled the less enthusiastic of his henchmen with consternation. To the general eye, he seemed to have pitched on the very point where the enemy wanted to meet with all the gain in their favor. This direct route to Richmond they had tried to make impregnable. The President, whom McClellan openly thwarted with unconcealed scorn for the civilian, was in profound distress. He called General Franklin into his council and inquired his opinion of the slowness of movements. "If something is not soon done in this dry rot, the bottom will fall out of the whole affair," this was his very saying. The Confederates evacuated Yorktown, but a series of actions ensued, culminating in the massacre at Fair Oaks, where both sides claimed the victory. Soon after, Lincoln took matters in hand, relegating McClellan to one army and, as commander-in-chief, ordering a general advance. The bottom had fallen out with a vengeance. End of section 285. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 286 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Master of Them Both. Read for LibriVox.org. General McClellan's attitude is such that in the very selfishness of his nature he cannot but wish to be successful, and I hope he will. And the Secretary of War, Stanton, is in precisely the same situation. If the military commanders in the field cannot be successful, not only the Secretary of War, but myself, for the time being master of both, cannot but be failures. Speech, August 6, 1862, at Washington. End of Section 286. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 287 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, The Skeered Virginian, read for LibriVox.org by Andrew Hoots. A reviewing party, of which the President was the center, was stopped at a railroad by Harper's Ferry to let a locomotive pass and look at the old engine house where John Brown, the raider, was penned in and captured. The little switching engine ran past with much noise and bustle, the engineer blowing the ludicrous whistle in salute to the distinguished visitors. Lincoln referred to the recollections of the scene where old Pottawatomie thrilled the natives with panic lest he raised the negroes to revolt, and remarked as the engine flew away, "You call that the Flying Dutchman, do you? They ought to call that thing the Scared Virginian." By General O. Howard, a hearer. End of Section 287. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 288 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. He Who Fights and Runs Away. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. He Who Fights and Runs Away. Shortly after the scandalous rout of Bull Run, the participants in the panic began to try to palliate the disgrace. The President, listening with revived sarcasm to the new perversion, remarked, "So it is your notion now that we licked the rebels and then ran away." End of Section 288. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 289 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. No Sunday Fighting. Read for LibriVox.org. As the first battle of Bull Run, a sanguinary defeat to the Unionists, was fought on the Sabbath day, the President forbade in the future important movements on the day desecrated. But with singular inconsistency in a sage so clear-headed, he did not see that the Southerners chuckled, "The better the day, the better the deed," in their victory. End of Section 289. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 290 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Let a Good Man Alone. General Howard, in taking command before Washington, incurred the hostility of certain officers of the convivial, plundering, swashbuckling order, who objected to his piety and orderliness. They tramped off to badger the President with their censure, but he who had appreciated the new leader in a glance reproved them, saying, "Howard is a good man. Let him alone. In time he will bring things straight." That was what caused the General to reverence him and love him. End of Section 290. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 291 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Blondin Simile. Read for LibriVox.org by Harold Stewart. One of the universal topics of the early 60s was the feats of the acrobat Blondin. This daring rope walker crossed the waters by Niagara Falls on a slack wire. On one occasion, he carried a man on his back, to whom he imparted the caution, grappling as with hooks of steel, "If you upset me with trembling, I shall drop you. I shall catch the rope and be safe. As for you, inexperienced one, phut!" The chain of defeats and flashes in the pan, attending the opening of the campaign, beginning as a march upon Richmond, [footnote: some northern newspapers kept a standing head, on to Richmond. But eventuating in a defense of Washington, humiliating as was this reverse, promoted all sorts and conditions of men, moneyed, well-grounded, and investing in the new government securities, fluctuating like wildcat stock, to pester the president with jeremiads and counsel. To one deputation from his home parts, he administered this caustic rebuke in such illustration as was habitual to him. Gentlemen, suppose all the property you were worth was in gold, and you had put it in the hands of Blondin to carry across the Niagara River on a rope. Would you shake the cable, or keep shouting out to him, "Blondin, stand up straighter! Blondin, stoop a little more! Go a little faster! Lean a little more to the north! To the south?" No. You would hold your breath as well as your tongue, and keep your hands off all, until he was safe over. The government, footnote, Lincoln always used government and U.S. as nouns carrying a plural verb, are carrying an immense weight. Untold treasures are in their hands. They are doing the very best they can. Don't pester them. Keep silence, and we will get you safe across. End of section 291. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 292 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Pioneer's Land Title. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. The Pioneer's Land Title. Judge Weldon was appointed United States Attorney, acting in Illinois. Being at Washington, some speculators, knowing he was an old friend of the President, engaged him for their side. They wanted to get cotton permits from the Treasury, which was feasible, but made sure that the military would recognize these passes, no doubt, if the President would countersign them. Otherwise, the Army officers acted often without regard to trade desires. On broaching the subject to the potentate, on whose lips so much hung at the epoch, the latter brightened up and in his branching-off manner said, "By the way, what has become of your friend Robert Lewis?" Lewis was the clerk of court in Illinois, and at home, well and thrifty. "Do you remember," continued the President, "his story about his going to Missouri to look up some Mormon lands belonging to his father?" Whereupon, as Weldon said that he had forgot some details, the storyteller related with unction. This Robert Lewis, on coming of age, found papers in his father's muniments, entitling him as heir to lands in northeastern Missouri, where the Mormons had attempted settling before their enforced exodus. There was no railroad, so Lewis rode out to that part and thought he had located the land. For the night he stopped at a solitary log house. A gruff voice bade him come in, not very hospitably. The owner was a long, lanky man, about 11 feet high, Bob thought. He had a rifle hanging on its hooks over the fireplace, also about 11 feet long, Bob also reckoned. He was interrupted in necking bullets, for they were cast in a mould, and left a little protuberance where the run left off. The first comer had been there some time, and seemed to know the section, but was rather indifferent to the stranger's inquiries about this site of his lands. Teased at this unconcern, so opposite to the usual feeling of settlers who like a neighbour in the lonesomeness, Lewis hastened to lay down the law. He was looking up the paternal purchase. Here were the titles, spreading out the papers. "That is my title, to this section. You are on it. What is yours?" The other had shown some slight interest in the topic by this time. He paused in his occupation and pointed with his long arm to the long rifle, saying, "Young man, do you see that gun? That is my title, and if you do not get out of here pretty quick, you will feel the force of it." Lewis crammed his papers into his saddlebags and rushed out to bestride his pony, but said that the man snapped his gun at him twice before he was out of range. "Now," resumed Mr. Lincoln, "the military authorities have the same title against the civil ones, the guns. The gentlemen themselves may judge what the result is likely to be. Mr. Weldon reported to his employers at Willard's Hotel, and they laughed heartily at the illustration. But they did not proceed with the cotton speck, understanding that would be the administration's policy as well as if a proclamation were issued. By Judge Weldon. End of section 292. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 293 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Read for LibriVox.org by Andrew Hoots. Cheers not military, but I like them. After the disarray of the first Bull Run battle, the President drove out to the camps to rally the boys in the Blues. General Sherman was only a colonel, and he had the rudeness of a military man to hint to the visitor that he hoped the orator would not speak so as to encourage cheering and confusion. The President stood up in his carriage and prefaced his speech with this exordium, "Don't cheer, boys. I confess that I rather like it myself. But Colonel Sherman here says it isn't military, and I guess we had better defer to his opinion." With his inimitable wink, which it would have been an independent fortune to a stage comedian. End of section 293. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 294 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Numbering the Hairs of His Tail? Read for LibriVox.org. A congressional committee selected to examine and report upon a new canon produced so voluminous a tome that Lincoln, reviewing it, dropped it in disgust and commented, "I should want a new lease of life to read this through. Why can't a committee of this kind occasionally exhibit a grain of common sense? If I send a man to buy a horse for me, I expect him to tell me his points, not how many hairs there are in his tail." Authenticated by Mr. Hubbard, Member of Congress of Connecticut, to whom this remark was addressed. End of section 294. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 295 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. An Unconventional Order. On going over the minor orders, riders, and corrections of the President, it will be seen that he never succumbed to conforming with the stale and set phrases of the civil service documents. For an instance of his unquenchable humor, read the following discharge. Two brothers, Smiths, of Boston, had been arrested, held, and persecuted for a long period by a military tribunal. The charge was defrauding the government. The hue and cry about the cheating contractors called for a victim, but the chief executive, on perusing the testimony, concluded that the defendants were guiltless. He wrote the subsequent release. Whereas Franklin W. and J.C. Smith had transactions with the Navy Department to the amount of $1.25 million, and whereas they had the chance to steal $1 million and were charged with stealing $2,200, and the question now is stealing $100, I don't believe they stole anything at all. Therefore, the record and findings are disapproved, declared null and void, and the defendants are fully discharged. End of section 295. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 296 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. It occurs to me that I am commander. Read for LibriVox.org by Morgan Dowdrick. It occurs to me that I am commander. To the prairie man, the climate of Washington would be almost tropical. Nevertheless, it participates of American meteorological variability, as old probability would admit. One night, Lincoln, coming out of his rooms at the Executive Mansion to make his nocturnal round, finishing with the call of the latest dispatches at garrison headquarters, noticed, as a fierce gale shook and scourged him with sleet, that a soldier was contending with the storm just outside the outer door. "Young man," said he, turning sharply to him, "you have got a cold job tonight. Step inside and guard there." The soldier stoutly contended, for the colloquy became an argument by Lincoln's delight in debate. He persisted that he was posted there by order and must not bulge save by superior countermand. "Hold on there," cried Lincoln, pleased at the arguer supplying him with a decisive weapon.
it occurs to me that I am Commander-in-Chief, and so I order you to go inside. End of Section 296. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 297 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Compliments is all they do pay. Read for LibriVox.org by Rebecca Case. A paymaster introduced to the President by the United States District Marshal remarked with independence noticeable in the sect, "I have no official business with you, sir. I only called to pay my compliments." "I understand," was the retort. "And from the soldiers' complaints, I think that is all you gentlemen do pay." End of Section 297. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 298 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Bail the Potomac with a Spoon. Read for LibriVox.org. There is as pathetic a picture as the old sated Marquis of Queensberry, Thackeray's Staines and History's Old Q, murmuring as he gazed from his window on the unsurpassed view of the Thames Valley, "Oh, this cursed river running on all the day," in President Lincoln watching the broad Potomac, where all was so quiet, and yet the hidden and watchful enemy lined the other bank. A petitioner hemmed him in a corner of the room with this sight, and poured on him the bucket of his woes. The at last irritated worm turned on him and cried, "My poor man, go away, do go away. I cannot meddle in your case. I could as easily bail the Potomac with a teaspoon as attend to all the details of the army." End of Section 298. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 299 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. "We Shall Beat Them, My Son." Read for LibriVox.org by Bill Elliott. Find me at www.vocability.com. That's VOCALBILLITY.com. "We Shall Beat Them, My Son." George W. Curtis, New York editor, called on the President in the first winter of the war with the Illinoisian's friend, Judge Arnold. He said that the official wore a sad, weary, and anxious look and spoke with a softened, touching voice. But he added to his goodbye at the door in shaking hands, with paternal kindness and profound conviction, "We shall beat them, my son. We shall beat them." End of Section 299. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 300 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Little for So Big a Business. Before the war, the museums of the eastern states were regaled by an infant drummer. This lad, Henry W. Stowman, at the age of 7 or 8, was a proficient on the drum. He was seen by this editor executing solos of great difficulty and accompanying the orchestra with variations on his unpromising instrument, which musicians praised and in which he avoided monotony with precocious talent. Grown up, still a rare drummer, he was attached to the Germantown Hospital as a post-drummer. At the first inauguration he was with the band and noticed by the President. With his habit of applauding the young, the latter spoke to him, commended his playing, and remarked, "You are a very little man to be in this big business." He took him up, kissed him, and paternally set him down, drum and all. Mr. Stowman lived to the age of 40 with this pretty memory. End of Section 300. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 301 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Not Shoulder Straps, but Hardtack. Read for LibriVox.org. At a military function, when Lincoln presented a new commander to a legion, one of the soldiers burst out with that irreverence distinguishing the American volunteer, "It is not shoulder straps, the officer's insignia, but hardtack that we want." Hardtack was the nickname for the disused shipbread turned over to the army by remorseless contractors. End of Section 301. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 302 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Maryland, a good state to move from. Read for LibriVox.org by Captain Allegra. Thurlow Weed, prominent wire puller, presented as a preferable puppet to Montgomery Blair his choice, Henry Winter Davis, upon which the President said, "Davis? Judge David Davis put you up to this. He has Davis on the brain. A Maryland man who wants to get out. Maryland must be a good state to move from. Weed, did you ever hear, in this connection, of the witness in court asked to state his age? He said 60, as he was on the face of it much older, but persisted, the court admonished him, saying, "The court knows you to be older than 60. "Oh, I understand now," owned up the old fellow. "You're thinking of the 10 years I spent in Maryland. That was so much time lost and did not count." End of section 302. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 303 of The Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Don't Swap Horses Crossing a Stream. Read for LibriVox.org by Ernst Schnell. Don't Swap Horses Crossing a Stream. The setting up and the bowling over of the generals commanding the army defending Washington from McDowell at Bull Run to Meade at Gettysburg resembles a grim game at tenpins. The President, who tried to find a professional captain to relieve him of his responsibility as nominally war chief of the national forces, therefore smiled sarcastically when the 99th deputation came to suggest still another aspirant to be the new Napoleon, and said to it, "Gentlemen, your request and proposition remind me of two gentlemen in Kentucky. The flatlands there bordering on the rivers are subject to inundations, so the fordable creek becomes in an instant a broad lake, deep and rapidly running." These two riders were talking the common topic, in that famous bluegrass region where fillies and filles, as the voyageur from Canada said in his broken English, are unsurpassable for grace and beauty. Each fell to expatiating upon the good qualities of his steed, and this dialogue was so animated and engrossing they approached a ford without being conscious of outer matters. There was heavy rain in the highlands and an ominous sound in the dampening air. They entered the water still arguing. Then, at midway, while they came to the agreement to exchange horses, with no boot, since each conceded the value of the animals, the river rose. In a twinkling, the two horses were floundering, and the riders, taken for once off their balance, lost stirrup and seat, and the four creatures separated were struggling for a footing in the boiling stream. Away streaked the horses, buried in foam 3 or 4 miles down, while the men scrambled out upon the new edge. "Gentlemen," concluded the President, drawing his morale with his provoking imperturbability, "those men looked at each other as they dripped and said with one voice, 'Ain't this a lesson? Don't swap horses crossing a stream.'" Heard by Superintendent Tinker, War Telegrapher. End of section 303. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 304 of The Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. No Placing Thorns in the Side of My Worst Enemy. Read for LibriVox.org. The free Constitution of Maryland was the work of Lincoln. His and its supporters made a party to go to Washington and congratulate the President on the victory. They had a band and serenaded him in the White House until he came forth. But he said, to the dampening of their ardor, when the cheering had subsided, "My friends, I appreciate this honor very highly, but I am very sorry to see you rejoice over the defeat of those opposed to us. It is furthest from my desire to place a thorn in any one's side, though he be my worst enemy. Recited by Mr. High G. Willis, Baltimore, in the Sun of that city." End of section 304. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 305 of The Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Lincoln Plan of Campaign. This historical document promised at one time to be a problem like the Sibylline Leaves or Czar Peter's will, but Secretary H. C. Whitney declares that it existed as he had it laid before him by the strategist. Running his long finger down the map of Virginia, he said, "We must drive them away from here, Manassas Gap, where indeed were fights over the Keystone, and clear them out of this part of the state, so that they cannot threaten them here, Washington, and get to Maryland." Unfortunately, the rebels did threaten Washington right on, and entered Maryland and Pennsylvania as late as July 1863, and by a cavalry raid a year later. "We must keep up a good and thorough blockade of their ports. We must march an army into East Tennessee and liberate the Union sentiment there." This was not finally done till the end of 1864. "Finally, we must rely on the Southern people growing tired and saying to their leaders, 'We have had enough of this thing and will bear it no longer.'" In 1862, a year after, Lincoln says to McClellan, "We have distinct and different plans for a movement of the Army of the Potomac, yours to be down the Chesapeake, etc., mine to move directly to the point on the railroad southwest of Manassas." He hugs his original idea. "In case of disaster, would not a retreat be more difficult by your plan than mine?" You see the prudence in him esteemed ignorant and consequently blindly rash. All this amounted to nothing when the President trusted fully to Grant as his lieutenant. End of Section 305. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 306 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Commander Should Obey Orders. Read for LibriVox.org. The President at Fort Stevens was the mark for a rebel battery. A colonel in command was diffident about ordering the superior about, but he was averse to letting the dare bring on a fatality, as the sharpshooters had an easy butt in the Lincoln exceptionable figure. So he took the advice of Mr. Registrar Chittenden, on the staff, and bade the President retire, or he would move him by a file of men. "And you would do quite right, my boy," acquiesced the chief. "I should be the last man to set an example of disobedience." End of Section 306. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 307 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Idlers Equaled the Effectives. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. The Idlers Equaled the Effectives. During a review of General Howard's corps on the Rappahannock in April 1863, President Lincoln noticed, whether his eyes were unmilitary or not, that a very numerous mass of men were spectators. Though wearing semi-soldiery look and clothes, they were, in fact, the inevitable hangers-on of an army, the more in number as the escaped slaves were welcomed by the soldiers, as they made them do their dirty work. The commanding general explained that they were the cooks, the bottle washers, and the nigger waiters. They had come out to see the President. "That review yonder," returned Lincoln gently as he smiled, "is about as big as ours." By General O.O. Howard. End of Section 307. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 308 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Rest. Read for LibriVox.org. Sitting before his desk in his office at the White House, Lincoln quaintly uttered, "I wish George Washington or some of these old patriots were here in my place, so I could have a little rest." Heard by General Veal. End of Section 308. This recording is in the public domain.
Chapter 309 of The Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. I can bear censure but not insult. I can bear censure but not insult. An army officer appeared before the President with a statement of his defense against a sentence of cashiering. He was told that his own paper did not warrant the superior interference, but he showed up twice more, repeating the plea and the version of his own preparation. At the continued repulse, he blurted out, "I see, Mr. President, that you are not disposed to do me justice." If Lincoln was the embodiment of any one virtue, it was justice to all. At this slur, he sprang up and put the fellow out of the door by a lift of his collar, saying, never show yourself in this room again. I can bear censure, but not insult. End of chapter 309. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 310 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, A Battle of Roses. At every reverse to the Unionists, the more or less secret sympathizers with the seceders reiterated the cry that gentler measures should be used against our erring brothers. To one such pleader, the President severely but humorously responded in writing, "Would you have me drop the war where it is, or would you prosecute it in future with elderstock squirts charged with rosewater?" Mr. Lincoln may or may not have said this and thus, but he certainly wrote it, for which we see his letter to C. Bullitt, July 28, 1862. Guns of elder squirts are mentioned by his dear Shakespeare. End of section 310. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 311 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Help Me Let Go. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. Help Me Let Go. The year 1862 had its gold in the victories of Murfreesboro and Perryville in the west, but in the neighbourhood of the capital, General Burnside's defeat at Fredericksburg, while his supporters counted on his justifying his superseding McClellan, clouded all Washington. The staff officer, footnote, an account says it was Governor Curtin in person, who brought the painful news, saw that the President was so saddened that he faltered an apology for the nature of his mission. "I wish, Mr. President, that I might be the bearer of good instead of bad news. I wish I brought the intelligence by which you could conquer or get rid of these rebellious states." His hearer smiled at the essay to cheer him, who believed he would never sleep again, and related with a view to enliven him also the story of Help Me Let Go. The version circulating viva voce ran as follows. "That reminds me of the camp where a bear suddenly made his appearance and scattered the party. All save one shinned up trees or got behind rocks, and that one meeting the animal head-on, before he could turn, seized Bruin by the ears and held on like grim death to a dead nigger. Recovering from their fright, the hunters came out of ambush and were unable to do anything but laugh at the fix their friend was in. 'You ain't mastered, are you?' asked they. 'Not licked, but I want you to help me let go.' Mr. Lincoln expressed himself when he said he was so slow to learn and slow to forget. The two qualities are redeemed by his wonderful ease and quickness in remembering. To quote well is good, but to quote fitly is better. His intimates noticed that he would re-echo a story, a smile or a tag, and so neatly apply it that it seemed fresh on the second use. He was an admirable actor, though not appreciated in that light, for he could reappear in the same part without palling. Hence one often meets his stories, as for instance this one. His life-law partner, Herndon, tells it as used toward a petty judge in Illinois, of inferior ability to Lincoln's. It was a murder case, and this bully on the bench kept ruling against Herndon and Lincoln. A material point was ruled adversely just at the refreshment recess. Lincoln withdrew sore, as he believed that the judge was personally controverting his positions. He avowed his own feelings and announced, "I have determined to crowd the court to the wall and regain my position before night." As Judge Herndon was a bystander, his account of the further proceedings must be as faithful as veracious. At the reassembling of court, Mr. Lincoln rose to read a few authorities in support of his position, keeping within the bounds of propriety just far enough to avoid reprimand. He characterized the continuous rulings against him as not only unjust but foolish, and figuratively speaking, peeled the court from head to foot. Lincoln was alternately furious and eloquent, and after pursuing the court with broad facts and pointed inquiries in rapid succession, he made use of this homely incident to clinch his argument. The tale is given as about a wild boar. In either phrase, the point is that the judge was attached to his tartar and wanted to be let go. The prosecution tried in vain to break Lincoln down, concludes Mr. Herndon, and the judge, badgered effectually by Lincoln's masterly arraignment of law and fact, pretended to see the error of his former position, and finally reversed his decision in his tormentor's favour. Lincoln saw his triumph and surveyed a situation of which he was master. End of section 311. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 312 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Splitting the Difference. Read for LibriVox.org. Upon the Western Virginia Stateship Bill passing in Congress, an opponent, Mr. Carlyle, ran to the President. He urged him to veto the bill. "Well, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll split the difference and say nothing about it." Frank Moore. End of section 312. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 313 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. In the Inca's Position. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. In the Inca's Position. Long after the President reconsidered his hasty surmise that the impending war was artificial crisis, Congress continued to waver, and no one put forward a definite or working policy for the head who avowed that he never had one. In his despondency and lonesomeness, he welcomed an old friend from his state, who, however, like the rest, had his frets and rubs to seek solace for. "You know better than any man living that from boyhood up my ambition was to be president. I am, at least, president of one part of the divided country. But look at me. With a fire in my front, and one in my rear to contend with, and not receiving that cordial cooperative support from Congress, reasonably expected, with an active and formidable enemy in the field threatening the very lifeblood of the government, my position is anything but on a bed of roses." End of section 313. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 314 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Blind Fortune. Read for LibriVox.org by Harold Stewart. A soldier, shot in the head so as to be deprived of sight in both eyes, left the Carver Hospital, Washington, and blundered in crossing the avenue. At that very moment, the President's carriage was coming along to the soldier's home from the mansion. The coach alone would probably have not brought any casualty upon the unfortunate young invalid, but it was again surrounded by one of the cavalry detachments, which Lincoln insisted on being withdrawn, but it was replaced for the time. The soldier, hearing this double clatter of hoofs, became bewildered, and stood still in the mid-road, or, if anything, inclined toward the thundering danger. The cavalry chargers, trained to avoid hurting men, for a rider might be thrown, eluded contact, and the coachman neatly pulled aside. In the next moment, in a cloud of dust, the President, leaning out of the window to ascertain the cause of the abrupt stop, saw the poor young soldier by his side. Lincoln threw out a hand to seize him by the arm and reassure him of safety by the vibrating clutch. Then, perceiving the nature of the affair, he asked, in a voice trembling with emotion, about the man's regiment and disablement. The man was from the Northwest, Michigan. Lumbermen, and they are of the woods woody out there, and Lincoln believed in the axe as the enlarger of our borders, our brotherly. The next day the soldier was commissioned lieutenant with perpetual leave, but full pay, by the veteran reservist H.W. Knight of the escort. End of section 314. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 315 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Little David and the Stone for Goliath. In the spring 1862, spies and foreign officers who had seen the rebel ram Merrimack being built at Norfolk, reported her as formidable. The United States Galena, our first ironclad, was a failure. There was no vessel of the kind to deal with the monster, save Ericsson's floating battery, ready for sea in March, called the Monitor, as a warning to Great Britain, expected to interfere on behalf of the South and raise the blockade over the cotton ports. This craft, with a revolving turret, was just as much of a new idea as its prototype. On March 8, the Merrimack came out of Norfolk and ran down the Cumberland Sloop of War, blew the Congress to splinters and compelled her being blown up to save her from the enemy, the Minnesota was run aground to prevent being rammed. The Victor returned to her dock to make ready for a fresh onslaught. The effect was profound. It seemed no exaggeration to suppose that the irresistible conqueror would pass through the United States fleet at Hampton Roads and, speeding along the coast, reduce New York to the most onerous terms or to ashes. On Sunday the 9th, the Monitor arrived after a sea passage, showing she rode too low for ocean navigation. Though in no fit state for battle, no time was allowed her, as the Merrimack ran out to exult over the ruins of the encounter. The Monitor threw herself in her way, bore her broadside without injury, and her shock with impunity, but on the other hand hurled her extremely heavy ball in under her waterline. The ram backed out, and, wheeling and putting on full steam, returned to her haven. She was, it appears, too low to cross the bar to go up to Richmond, and was not ocean-going. She was blown up when Yorktown was evacuated by the Confederates in May 1862. The President had said of her defeater, to some naval officers, "I think she will be the veritable sling with the stone to smite the Philistine Merrimack." End of section 315. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 316 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Lincoln's Cheese Box on a Raft. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. Lincoln's Cheese Box on a Raft. There is a chapter yet to be published upon ironclad warships, as introduced practically in the Civil War. To the Southerners is due the innovation on a fair scale, though their experiments were not at all profitably demonstrative. Upon rumours that the enemy were building the novelties of iron-case vessels, the federal government responded by voting money, and throwing it away upon a fiasco. Meanwhile, the others had raised the frigate, the Merrimack, and upon an angular roof laid railroad iron to make her shot-proof. Stories of her likelihood to be a terror, especially as she was stated by spies to be seaworthy, inspired the Americanized Swedish naval engineer Ericsson to build a turret ship. The Naval Construction Board unanimously rebuffed the innovator. Luckily, President Lincoln became interested as a flatboat builder in his youth. He took up the inventor and the design. He scoffed at the idea that the man had not planned thoroughly, saying, as to weight of the armor sinking the hull, "Out west, in boat building, we figured out the carrying power to a nicety." His championship earned the Monitor the name of Lincoln's Cheese Box on a Raft. The Assistant Secretary of the Navy, knowing all the facts, observes, "I withhold no credit from Captain John Ericsson, her inventor, but I know the country is principally indebted to President Lincoln for the construction of this vessel, and for the success of the trial to Captain Worden." Captain Fox, Ericsson's adviser, confirms this credit. End of section 316. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 317 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. No Dutch Courage. Read for LibriVox.org. After the miraculous intervention of the Ericsson Monitor, the President took a party aboard to inspect the little champion which had saved the fleet, and perhaps the capital, where the captain received them. He apologized for the limited accommodation, and for the lack of the traditional lemon and necessary attributes for a presidential visit. But the teetotaler chief merrily replied, "Some uncharitable persons say that old Bourbon valor inspires our generals in the field, but it is plain that Dutch courage was not needed on board of the Monitor." End of section 317. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 318 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. If I had as much money and was as badly scared. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. If I had as much money and was as badly scared. In March 1862, after her terrifying exploits, the Merrimack ram was reported to have escaped to sea and was seeking fresh prey to devour. The eastern seaports were in a panic. A deputation of New York's merchant princes, bullion barons, and plutocrats generally, representing 100 millions, was the rumor heralding their rush visit to the capital, arrived at the White House. The spokesman faltered that the great metropolis was in peril, that treasures were involved by the apprehension, and that, in brief, the government ought to take measures to defend the Empire City from the spite of this irresistible ocean terror. At the conclusion, the patient hearer responded, "Well, gentlemen, the government has at present no vessel which can sink the Merrimack." They were not, for state reasons, to know what the sly fox had up his sleeve. The government is pretty poor, its credit is not good, its legal tender notes are worth only 40 cents on your Wall Street, and we have to pay you a high rate of interest on our loans. Now, if I were in your place, and had as much money as you represent, and was as badly scared as you say you are, I'd go right back to New York and build some war vessels and present them to the government. Authenticated by Charlotte Colfax, afterward Vice President under General Grant, and by Judge Davis, who presented the delegation. End of section 318. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 319 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. It pleases her, and it don't hurt me. Read for LibriVox.org by Jerusha Renstrom. It pleases her, and it don't hurt me. April 1862 closed brilliantly for the Union, as New Orleans was captured. General Porter Phelps issued a proclamation which freed the slaves. As on previous occasions, when this bomb was brought out, the President had directed its being stifled and reserved for his occasion. There was wonder that he took no official notice of the premature flash. Taken to task by a friendly critic for his odd omission, he deigned to reply, "Well, I feel about it a good deal like that big, burly, good-natured canal laborer who had a little, waspy bit of a wife in the habit of beating him. One day she put him out of the house and switched him up and down the street. A friend met him a day or two after and rebuked him with the words, 'Tom, as you know, I have always stood up for you, but I am not going to do it any longer. Any man may stand for a bully-ragging by his wife, but when he takes a switching from her right out on the public highway, he deserves to be horsewhipped.' Tom looked up with a wink on his broad face, and slapped the interferer on the back with a leg of mutton fist, rejoined, 'Why, drop it! It pleases her, and it don't hurt me.'" End of section 319. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 320 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Let him squeal if he works. One of the Northern War Governors was admirably loyal and devoted to the Reunion, but he was set on doing things his own way and protested every time he was called on for men or material. Lincoln saw that he was willing and was only like the lady who, methinks, protests too much. So he told Secretary Stanton, who laid before him the objections, "Never mind, these dispatches do not mean anything. Go right ahead. The governor reminds me of a boy I knew at a launching. He was a small boy, chosen to fit the hollow in the midst of the ways where he should lie down, after knocking out the king dog, which holds the ship on the stocks, when all other checks are removed. The boy did everything right, but yelled as if he was being murdered every time the keel rushed over him in the channel. I thought the hide was being peeled from his back, but he wasn't hurt a mite. The shipyard master told me that the boy was always chosen for the job, doing his work well and never being hurt, but that he always squealed in that way. Now that's the way with our governor. Make up your mind that he is not hurt and that he is doing the work all right, and pay no attention to his squealing. To his confidant, General Veal, the president said, "We cannot afford to quarrel with the governors of the loyal states about collateral issues. We want their soldiers." End of section 320. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 321 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Brigadiers cheap, chargers costly. Read for LibriVox.org. The news was transmitted to the executive that a brigadier general and his escort of cavalry had been gobbled up, the current and expressive term, by rebel raiders near Fairfax Courthouse, close enough to resound the echoes of the affray. "I am sorry of the loss of the horses," deplored the president. "I mean that I can make a brigadier general any day, but those horses cost the government $125 to $50 a head." End of section 321. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 322 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. To Cure Singing in the Head. Read for LibriVox.org by Rebecca Case. The key to the trammels which bore upon the several generals of the Army of the Potomac is found in the fears of the inhabitants of the capital that at the least weakness in its defenders there would be a shifting of the two governments, and the Richmond one would replace that at Washington. Footnote. This seems unlikely now, but General Lee and many competent judges clung to the belief that, had his General Early held his position at Gettysburg, Jefferson Davis, and not Abraham Lincoln, would have occupied Washington's seat, for a time anyway. But if, the story of the Civil War is studded with ifs. But the Navy was not considered in this relation. Hence, there was a proposition to draw the rebel forces from the north by threatening the southern seaports with naval attacks, and descents of the tars and marines. A deputation visited the president with this project. He listened to its unfolding with his proverbial patient attention and rejoined, "This reminds me of the case of a girl out our way, troubled with a singing in the head. All the remedies having been uselessly tried, a plain, common horse-sense sort of fellow," he bowed to the deputation, "was called in. The cure is simple," he said, "what is called by sympathy. Make a plaster of psalm tunes and apply to the feet. It will draw the singing down and out." Repeated by Frank Carpenter's Recollections. End of section 322. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 323 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Bowing to the Boy of Battles. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. Bowing to the Boy of Battles. Congressman W. D. Kelly wished to procure the admittance of a youth into the naval school. Though a lad, he had shown the mettle of a man on two serious occasions while belonging to the gunboat Ottawa. The President has the right to send three candidates to the school yearly, who have served a year in the naval service. Thrilled by the recital of the youth's heroic conduct, the President wrote to the Secretary of the Navy to have the boy put on the list of his appointees. But the subject was found short of the age required. He would not be 14 until September of that year, and it was but July. Lincoln had the hero appear before him. He admired him frankly and altered the order so as to suit the later date. He bade the boy go home and have a good time during the 2 months, as about the last holiday he would get. The President had reconsidered his first impression that the disturbance was but an artificial excitement. "And that's the boy who did so gallantly in those two great battles," he mused. "Why, I feel that I should bow to him, and not he to me. Authority by Congressman W. D. Kelly. The person was Willie Bladen, USN. End of section 323. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 324 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. When Washington Was All One Tavern. Read for LibriVox.org. As men winning with Mars expect to sup with Pluto, the drinking at the Capitol during the war was horrifying. The bars were overflowing with officers, and while, as Orpheus C. Kerr was saying of the Civil Service Corps, that spilling red ink was very different from spilling red blood, the novices in uniform were staining their new coats with port. Coming out of the West with the unique recommendation, "This gentleman from Kentucky never drinks," President Lincoln had only the American standby, the ice-water pitcher, on his sideboard. And up to the last, even when the jubilation upon the war's close made many a stopper fly out of the tabooed bottle, he could say, "My example never belied the position I took when I was a young man." So he could reply to a New England woman's temperance deputation, probably believing the caricaturist who pictured old Abe mint juleping with the eagle. "They would be rejoiced if they only knew how much I have tried to remedy this great evil." Indeed, he was still meddling when he wrote and spoke against drunken habits in the army, especially among the officers. End of section 324. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 325 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Break the Critter, Wear Slim. Lincoln's letters to his generals would be a revelation of character if it were not already famed. He warns Fighting Joe Hooker in June 1863 not to get entangled in the Rappahannock, like an ox jumped half over a fence and liable to be torn by dogs, front and rear, without a fair chance to give one way or kick the other. Later, fight Lee, too, when opportunity offers. If he stays where he is, fret him, and fret him. Finally, if the head of Lee's army is at Martinsburg, and the tail on the plank road between Fredericksburg and Chancellorsville, the critter must be slim somewhere. Could you not break him there? End of section 325. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 326 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. How Get Him Out. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. How Get Him Out. During the avalanche of plans to conduct the suppression of the rebellion, a genius proposed what afterwards seemed a forecast for Sherman's march to the sea. But at the time, Lincoln saw in it merely a desperate venture which would detail a rescue party much more important. "That reminds me," he said with his whimsical smile, "of a cooper out my way, new at the trade and much annoyed by the head falling in as he was hooping in the staves around it. But the bright idea occurred to him to put his boy in to hold up the cover. Only when the job was completed by this inner support, the new problem rose. How to get the boy out? Your plan is feasible, sir, but how are you to get the boy out?" The story was originally credited to a Chinese cooper, to whom modern cask-making was a mystery. End of section 326. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 327 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. A Pleasure to Preside at Last. Read for LibriVox.org by Carol Stripling. On the 4th of March, 1863, when Congress was closing the session, President Lincoln gave away the bride at a marriage ceremony held, by his invitation, in the House of Representatives chamber. This seems a singular and high honor to the couple. Their preeminence and the function being acclaimed by all the notables connected with the field and the forum in the Capitol was a characteristic testimonial to the comforters whose service to the soldier was inestimable. The pair were John A. Fowle and Elida Rumsey, the man from Boston, the lady from New York. They were both attendants on the hospitals at the front when their acquaintance verged into community and this eventful matrimony. Lincoln had met both in his continuous calls at the hospitals and offered the west wing of the Capitol building for the wedding. He gave away the bride, and in the records figure his name and those of the illustrious witnesses. He gave a huge basket of the finest flowers from the White House conservatory. He stayed to witness the dedication of the Soldiers' Library, founded by Mr. Fowle, who had seen the errant want of reading matter by our soldiers, so few being illiterate. At the President's hint, Congress granted the ground for the library, but the pension office now occupies the site. 63 was a dark year, and the President might well say on this typical incident, during a time there was little marrying, "It is for once a pleasure to preside." End of section 327. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 328 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. On the Lord's Side. Read for LibriVox.org. On a pastor assuring the President that the Lord is on our side, he replied, "I am not at all concerned about that, for I know that the Lord is always on the side of right. But it is my constant anxiety and prayer that I and this nation should be on the Lord's side." End of section 328. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 329 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Going to Canaan. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. Going to Canaan. Although the South is a poetic country, no bard wrote any Marcellus hymn on that side. One of the few effusions bidding tolerably for public was Lincoln Going to Canaan, a parody on the numerous Negro camp meeting lays in which Lincoln was hailed as the coming Moses. This burlesque was laid before Mr. Lincoln, he taking the grim relish in hits at him. Caricatures and sallies which great men never spun. "Going to Canaan," he is reported to have said. "Going to Canaan, I expect." End of section 329. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 330 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Going to Canaan. Although the South is a poetic country, no bard ever wrote any Marseillaise hymn on that side. One of the few effusions bidding tolerably for publicity was Lincoln Going to Canaan, a parody on the numerous Negro camp meeting lays in which Lincoln was hailed as the coming Moses. This burlesque was laid before Mr. Lincoln, he taking the grim relish in hits at him, caricatures and sallies, which great men never spurn. "Going to Canaan," he is reported to have said. "Going to Canaan, I expect." End of section 330. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 331 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Fox Appointed Paymaster. Read for LibriVox.org by Andy from Invernahyne, Scotland. The President came into the telegraph office of the White House laughing. He had picked up a child's book in his son Tad's room and looked at it. It was a story of a motherly hen, struggling to raise her brood to live honest and useful lives. But in her efforts, she was greatly annoyed by a mischievous fox. She had given him many lectures on his wicked ways, and, said the President, "I thought I would turn over to see the finis, to see how they came out." This is what it said. And the fox became a good fox, and was appointed paymaster in the army. I think it very funny that I should have appointed him a paymaster. I wonder who he is. Such inability to distinguish one officer as good does not speak highly for the eradication of the soldier's prejudice for the gentry. Superintendent Tinker. End of Section 331. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 332 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, Risking the Dictatorship, read for LibriVox.org. Every one of the generals leading the Army of the Potomac was accused of the longing for the presidency, which placed the occupant in a peculiar predicament. Of General Joe Hooker, it was said in the press and in the Washington hotels that he was the man on horseback, and would, at the final success of clearing out the rebel beleaguers, set up as dictator. Hence the letter which Lincoln wrote to him. I have heard in such a way as to believe it, of your recently saying that both the army and the government needed a dictator. Of course, it was not for this, but in spite of it, that I have given you the command of the Army of the Potomac. What I ask of you is military success, and I will risk the dictatorship. It was April 1863. Hooker issued the stereotyped address, full of confidence on taking command, advanced and withdrew his army after the repulse by Lee. All he scored was the death of Stonewall Jackson, Lee's right hand, and that was an accident. As Lee invaded Maryland, all hopes of Hooker's dictatorship were dispersed in the battle smoke penetrating too far north to be pleasant incense to fallen heroes. End of Section 332. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 333 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, A Stage in the Ceaseless March Onward to Victory, read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. A Stage in the Ceaseless March Onward to Victory. Veterans will remember the peculiar effort on a forced march of the younger or less enduring comrade falling asleep as to all but his eyes and the muscles employed, but stepping out and apparently sustained only by the touching of elbows in the lurching from the ruts in the obliterated road. On the night of the stunning news of the last conflict at Chancellorsville, Lincoln could derive no comfort from later intelligence. Late at night, General Halleck, commanding the capital, and Secretary Stanton left him unconsoled. Then his secretary, as long as he stayed, heard the man on whom rested the national hopes, her very future, pace his room without pause save to turn. It was like the fisher on the banks who must keep wake for a chance at a grab of the chains of the ship that may burst through the fog and crush his smack like a coconut shell. At midnight the chief may have stopped to write, for there was a pause, but a breathing spell. Then the pacing again till the attaché left at 3 a.m. When he came in the morning, not unanxious himself, he found his chief eating breakfast alone in the unquitted room. On the table lay a sheet of written paper, instructions for General Hooker to renew fighting, although it only brought the slap on the other cheek, at Winchester. And still Lee pressed on into Pennsylvania till Harrisburg was menaced. But Meade supplanted Fighting Joe, and the Gettysburg wiped out the shame of the later repulses. The private secretary was W. O. Stoddard. End of Section 333. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 334 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Working for a Living Makes One Practical. Read for LibriVox.org by Rebecca Case. The year 1863 was blackletted in the North by disaster. General Hooker had been badly beaten by General Lee. The Confederate advance into Pennsylvania shook the strongest faith in the triumph of the Federal arms, and the victory of Gettysburg was attained at a bloody cost. The draft riots in New York excited a fear that the discontent with the colossal strife was deep-rooted. General Thomas, at Chickamauga, saved the Union army from destruction, but the call for 300,000 3 years' men denoted that the end was not even glimpsed. Nevertheless, this latter feat of arms gladdened tremulous Washington, and among the exploits was cited to the President the desperate victualling of General Thomas' exhausted troops by General Garfield. He performed a dangerous ride from Rosencrantz to the beleaguered victor and brought him craved-for provisions. "How is it?" inquired President Lincoln of an officer, courier of the details. that Garfield did in 2 weeks what would have taken one of your West Pointers 2 months to accomplish. The recollection was perfectly well understood by the regular, who thought the amateur commander meddled too much with the operations of the field. Because he was not educated at West Point, was the reply, but half in jest. No, that was not the reason, corrected the questioner. It was because, when a boy, he had to work for a living. He rewarded the purveyor general with the rank of major general. End of section 334. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 335 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, Hold On and Cha. While in July 1863, General Grant was held at Vicksburg by a siege which he successfully prosecuted, the New York draft riots broke out. Without knowing from experience that a riot, however pretentious, must cease when the mob are drunk or spent, the inevitable contingencies, in his alarm General Halleck, at Washington, begged General Grant to send reinforcements, that he might not weaken the capital defenses to any extent. The commander of the West declined and referred to the President. General Horace Porter was on Grant's staff and saw his smiles as he read the dispatch from headquarters. "The President has more nerve than any of his advisers," observed he to his officers, for Lincoln did not agree with his cabinet as to the revolution in the rear, and the message was sent by the staff. "I have seen your dispatch expressing your unwillingness to break your hold. Neither am I willing. Hold on with a bulldog grip, and chaw and choke as much as possible." End of section 335. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 336 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, The Great National Job, read for LibriVox.org. The signs look better. The Father of Waters again goes unvexed to the sea. The job was a great national one, and let none be banned who bore an honorable part in it. And while those who cleared the great river may well be proud, even that is not all. It is hard to say that anything has been more bravely and well done than at Antietam, Murfreesboro, Gettysburg, and on many fields of lesser note. Nor must Uncle Sam's web feet be forgotten. Not only on the deep sea, the broad bay, and the rapid river, but also up the narrow, muddy bay, and wherever the ground was a little damp, they have been and made their tracks. Thanks to all for the great Republic. Letter by President Lincoln, regretting inability to attend a meeting of unconditional Union men at Springfield, Illinois, dated August 26, 1863, to J. C. Conkling. End of section 336. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 337 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, For Flaying a Man Alive, read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. For Flaying a Man Alive. A representative of Ohio, Alexander Long, proposed in the House a recognition of the Southern Confederacy. It must be borne in mind that before the firing on the supply steamer at Charleston, which was dispatched surreptitiously, not to offend the sympathizer's susceptibilities, many good citizens, dwelling on the silence of the Constitution as to secession, said openly that they did not see why the state chafing under the partnership all the original 13 made, should not withdraw peacefully. Long was not solitary in his unseemly proposition, which, however, could never have been otherwise than untimely after the first shot. General Garfield met the issue with indignation. He called the act treason, and denounced the author as a second Benedict Arnold. He entreated loyal representatives to not believe that another such growth on the soil of Ohio deformed the face of nature and darkened the light of God's day. When this speech met the President's eye, he hastened to thank General Garfield for having flayed Long alive. End of section 337. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 338 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, One on 'em not dead yet. Read for LibriVox.org by Carol Stripling. As communications were cut off with the North, intense anxiety was occasioned there by the situation in November 1863 of General Burnside, packed in Knoxville, Tennessee, by Longstreet's dreaded veterans. At last, a telegram reached the War Department, vaguely telling of firing heard in the direction of Knoxville. The President, reading, expressed gladness in spite of the remaining uncertainty. "Why?" said he to the group of officers and officials. "It reminds me of a neighbor of ours in Indiana, in the brush, who had a numerous family of young ones. They were all the time wandering off into the scrub, but she was relieved as to their being lost by a squall every now and then. She would say, 'Thank the laws, there is one still alive.' That is, I hope one of our generals is in the thicket, but still alive and kicking." Indeed, Burnside resisted a night-storming party, and Longstreet was not a lane that knew no turning, but turned and retreated. End of section 338. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 339 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The South Like an Ash Cake. Read for LibriVox.org. At the end of 1864, the Confederacy was scotched, if not quite killed. Sherman had halved it by striking into Savannah. East Tennessee and Southwest Virginia were cut by Stoneman. Alabama and Mississippi were traversed by Grierson and Wilson. In sum, the new map resembled that of a territory charted off into sections. President Lincoln said that its face put him in mind of a weary traveler in the West, who came at night to a small log cabin. The homesteader and his wife said they would put him up, but had not a bite of victuals to offer him. He accepted the truss of litter and was soon asleep. But he was awakened by whispers letting out that in the fire ashes a hoe cake was baking. The woman and her mate were merry over how they had defrauded the stranger of the food. Feeling mad at having been sent to bed supperless, uncommon mean in that part, he pretended to wake up and came forth to sit at the dying fire. He pretended, too, that he was ill from worry. "The fact is, my father, when he died, left me a large farm. But I had no sooner taken possession of it than mortgages began to appear. My farm was situated like this." He took up the loggerhead poker to illustrate, drawing lines in the ashes so as to enclose the ash cake. First one man got so much of it at one side. He cut off a side of the hidden dough. Then another brought in a mortgage and took off another piece there. Then another here, and another there, and here, and there, drawing the poker through the ashes to make the figure plain, until, he said, there was nothing of the farm left for anybody, which, I presume, is the case with your cake. And I reckon, concluded Mr. Lincoln, that the prospect is now very good of the South being as cut up as the ash cake. Telegraph Manager A. Chandler. End of section 339. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 340 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. I Count for Something. The true lovers of the South were sorely wrung in 1864 by the Emperor Napoleon taking advantage of the lockup of the United States to set a puppet in the Austrian Archduke Maximilian on the imperial throne, so called, of Mexico. It was said that the cabinet of Lincoln were divided on the subject, whereon the Marquis of Chambrun, having the ear of the executive, called on him and inquired on the real state, would the United States intervene, if only by winking at a filibustering expedition from the South, with Northern volunteers accessory, to assist the natives against the usurper? There has been war enough, was his rejoinder, with that sadness which Secretary Boutwell declares inseparable from him, but not due to the depression of public affairs. I know what the American people want, but, thank God, I count for something, and during my second term there will be no more fighting. It was left for his successor, with the two armies disbanded but still wedded for slaughter, to expel the French by the mere threat of their union to restore the Republic. End of section 340. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 341 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Read for LibriVox.org by Ruins. Passes no good for Richmond. A person solicited the President for a pass to Richmond, but the other replied caustically, "I should be happy to oblige you if my passes thither were respected, but I have issued 250,000 to go to Richmond, and not one man has gone there yet." End of Section 341. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 342 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Mare is the Better Horse. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. The Mare is the Better Horse. The Lowell Citizen editor participated in a presidential reception in 1864, just before the fall of Richmond. The usher giving intimation that the President would see his audience at once, all were ushered into the inner room. Abraham Lincoln's countenance bore that open, benignant outline expected, but what struck us especially was its cheerful, wide-awake expressiveness, never met with in the pictures of our beloved chief. The secret may have been that the Secretary Stanton, middle-aged, well-built, stern-visaged man, had brought in his budget good news from Grant. After saluting his little circle of callers, they were seated and attended to in turn. First in order was a citizen of Washington praying for pardon in the case of a deserter. "Well," said the President, after carefully reading the petition, "it is only natural for one to want a pardon, but I must in that case have a responsible name that I know. I don't know you. Do you live in the city?" "Yes." "Do you know him, the mayor?" "Yes." "Well, the mayor is the better horse. Bring me his name and I will let the boy off." The soldier was pardoned. End of Section 342. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 343 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Real Superior Thing to the Sham Battle. Read for LibriVox.org. On the 25th of March, 1864, in honor of the President's renewal of office, a grand review had been fixed at City Point, outside the Capitol. Whatever the opinion of the old military, the volunteers gave the civilian commander the soldier's vote. In imitation of the French soldiers dubbing Bonaparte the Little Corporal, after his Italian victories, the Americans promoted Lincoln to be their captain, as Walt Whitman worded it, after his repeated reinstatement. He was rapturously greeted by his boys in blue. But the arrangements made at Washington in the undisturbed council were upset by General Lee. On that very morning he had attacked and had taken Fort Stedman. To drive him out required a veritable action, not terminating for several hours. Lincoln visited the scene of the restoration after the carnage, and on hearing regrets that the review, the chief recreation of the Washingtonians, he checked the light-souled attendants with, "This victory is better than any review." End of Section 343. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 344 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Tool Turned on the Handle. Read for LibriVox.org by Harold Stewart. The scales having fallen from our sight, and the figure of the greatest American, standing out colossal and clean-cut, for posterity to worship as without a blemish. It is hard to measure the conceit of the clique of politicians, pettifoggers, and office-seekers, certainly assisting in the advancement of Abraham Lincoln, from confined obscurity in the West to the choice of the Northern nation. That was not enough, but still gauging him with their tape, they withheld justice from him, after he displayed his worth in meeting the impending crisis. When on the heels of the call for 300,000 men in 1863, came in spring, 1864, another for 500,000, to fortify General Grant in his finishing maneuvers, a murmur was heard. Chicago, gallantly having done her part, thought it was pumping at a void. A deputation from Cook County, headed by Lincolnites, departed for the capital to object to the summons. It was thought by his friends and long supporters that their own elect could not resist their plea or turn it off with a joke. This deputation fined down to 3 persons, as it was not a patriotic quest. One of them also wished to balk, being Joseph Medill, editor of the Chicago Tribune. As a matter of course, Secretary of War Stanton refused the indulgence, obdurate as he was. The President was likewise averse, but he did consent to go over the matter with Stanton. The result was the same. All was left solely to Lincoln, since the personal argument was implied by the mediums selected. "I," said Medill to Miss Tarbell, "I shall never forget how Mr. Lincoln suddenly lifted his head and turned on us a black and frowning face. 'Gentlemen,' said he, in a voice full of bitterness, 'after Boston, Chicago has been the chief instrument in bringing this war on the country. The Northwest has opposed the South, as New England opposed the South. It was you who were largely responsible for causing the blood to flow as it has. You called for war until we had it. You called for emancipation, and I have given it to you. Whatever you have asked, you have had. Now you come here, begging to be let off from the call for men which I have made to carry out the war you demanded. You ought to be ashamed of yourselves. I have a right to expect better things of you. Go home and raise your 6,000 extra men, the Cook County rate. And you, Medill, you are acting like a coward. You and your Tribune have had more influence than any paper in the Northwest in making this war. Go home and send us those men.' They went home, and they raised and sent those men." End of section 344. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 345 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Sooner the fowl by hatching the egg than smashing it. Still the question is not whether the Louisiana government, as it stands, is quite all that is desirable. The question is, will it be wiser to take it as it is and help to improve it, or to reject and disperse? Concede that the new government is to what it should be as the egg to the fowl, we shall sooner have the fowl by hatching the egg than by smashing it. Laughter. Speech by A. Lincoln, his last, in answer to a serenade at the White House, 11th April, 1865, amid illuminations for the victories. End of section 345. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 346 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Too busy to go into another business. Read for LibriVox.org. There came into the presidential hearing a man of French accent from New Orleans. He was evidently a diffident person, not knowing how precisely to state his case. But the burden of it was that he was a real estate holder in New Orleans, and since the advent of military rulers there, he could not collect his rents, his living. "Your case, my friend," said the President, "may be a hard one, but it might be worse. If with your musket you had taken your chances with the boys before Richmond, you might have found your bed and board before now. But the point is, what would you have me do for you? I have much to do, and the courts have been open to relieve me in this regard." The applicant, still embarrassed, said, "I am not in the habit of appearing before big men." "And for that matter," it was quickly responded, "you have no need to change your habit, for you are not before very big men now," playfully adding, "I am too busy to go into the rent collection business." End of 346. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 347 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Scale of Rebels. Read for LibriVox.org by Capnallegra. When, at the finale, Lincoln reproved his own wife for using the hackneyed expression of rebels, suggesting Confederates, as officially accepted on both sides, a wit commented, "The Southerners will be like the Jews. As a poor one is simply a Jew, a rich one a Hebrew, and a Rothschild an Israelite. So it will be rebels, Confederates, and our Southern brothers anew. End of section 347. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 348 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. One War at a Time. Read for LibriVox.org by Jerusha Renstrom. One War at a Time. When the Austrian Archduke Maximilian was foisted upon Mexico as its emperor by Napoleon III, the Southerners, who did not have their belly full of fighting by 1864, more than hinted that they would range shoulder to shoulder with the Federals to try to expel him and the mercenary Marshal Bazaine. But the President returned sagaciously, one war at a time. It was under his successor, Johnson, that the expulsion was effected, and the upstart executed by the exasperated Mexicans themselves. Note, this was undoubtedly said, but Mr. Henry Watterson, in his lecture on Lincoln, dates it as at the commencement of the war, when Secretary Seward, to forestall possible European alliances in favor of the Confederate States, proposed waging war against France and Spain, already allied, and challenging Russia and England to follow. End of section 348. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 349 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Again the Government. Read for LibriVox.org by Andrew from Inverarnon, Scotland. In the summer of 1864, the Governor-General of Canada paid the President a visit with a numerous escort. During the late unpleasantness, as much comfort as possible under the Neutrality Act was believed to have been given the raiders in the border towns, as witness the St. Albans bank steal and the outfitting of blockade runners. But they were treated at Washington with perfect courtesy. The head of the British party, at the conclusion, said with some sarcasm in his genial tone, "I understand, Mr. President, that everybody is entitled to a vote in this country. If we remain until November, can we vote?" "You would have to make a longer residence, which I could desire," politely replied the host. "Only I fear we should not gain much by that. For there was a countryman of Your Excellency from the sister kingdom of Ireland, though who came here and on landing wanted to exercise the privilege you seek, to vote early and often. But the officials at Castle Garden landing stage laughed at him, saying that he knew nothing about parties. To which he replied, 'Bother the parties. It is the same here with me as in the old country. I am again the government.' You see, he wanted to vote on the side of the rebellion. Your Excellency would then be no more at a loss to decide on which side." End of section 349. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 350 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, Plowing Around a Log. A state governor came to Washington, furious at the number of troops headquarters commanded of him and the mode of collecting them. Irate as he was, General Fry saw him bidding good-bye to the capital with a placid, even pleased, mien. The general inquired of Lincoln himself how he had been so miraculously mollified. "I suppose you had to make large concessions to him, as he returns from you entirely satisfied?" suggested the general. "Oh, no," replied the President, "I did not concede anything. You know how that Illinois farmer managed the big log that lay in the middle of his field? To the inquiries of his neighbors, he announced he had gotten rid of it.
"How did you do it?" they asked. "It was too big to haul away, too knotty to split, too wet and soggy to burn. Whatever did you do?" "Well, now, boys, if you won't tell the secret, I'll tell you how. I just plowed round it." "Now, Fry, don't tell anybody, but I just plowed around the governor." On the authority of General James B. Fry. End of section 350. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 351 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Not the Right Clay to Cement a Union. Read for LibriVox.org. In 1864, Horace Greeley, editor of the New York Tribune, and a great authority among the farming class and the extremists, consented to attend an abortive peace consultation with Southern representatives, George N. Sanders, Beverly Tucker, and Clement C. Clay at Niagara Falls. Clay was so set upon Jefferson Davis being still left as a ruler in some high degree, which would condone his action as president of the seceded states. The project, like others, was a fizzle, as Lincoln would have said. To our president, Henry Clay was the beau ideal of a statesman, but it was clear that his namesake was not of the clay to cement a new union. End of section 351. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 352 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Man Down South. Read by Andy from Inverarnon, Scotland. In August 1864, a painful absorption was noticed in the President's manner, growing more and more strained and depressed. The ancient smile was fainter when it flitted over the long-drawn features, and the eyes seemed to bury themselves out of light in the cavernous sockets, too dry for tears. These withdrawing fits were not uncommon, but they had become frequent this summer, and at the reception he had mechanically passed the welcome and given the handshake. But then the abstraction became so dense that he let an old friend stand before him without a glance, much less the usual hearty greeting expected. The newcomer, alarmed, ventured to arouse him. He shook off his absence of mind, seized the hand proffered him, and, while grasping it, exclaimed as though no others were by, also staring and pained, "Excuse me, I was thinking of a man down south." He was thinking of Sherman, that military genius who burned his ships and penetrated a hostile country, like Cortes, and from whom no reliable news had been received while he was investing Savannah. Lincoln had in his mind been accompanying his captain on that forlorn march, smashing things to the sea. End of section 352. This recording is in the public domain. Recording by Andy, MELYS.WS.
Section 353 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Dismembered Yellow Dog. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. The Dismembered Yellow Dog. Toward the end of December 1864, the news trickled in of the utter discomfiture of Confederate General Hood's army at Nashville by General Thomas. An enthusiastic friend of the President said to him, "There is not enough left of Hood to make a dish rag, is there?" "Well, no, Medill. I think Hood's army is in about the identical fix of Bill Sykes' dog." The application from Dickens is noticeably as showing Lincoln's eclectic reading. Down in Sangamon County. Did you never hear it? As a Chicago man, Mr. Medill might be allowed to be ignorant of Sangamon Valley incidents. Well, this Bill Sykes had a long, hungry yellow dog, forever getting into the neighbours' meat smokehouses and chicken coops and the like. They had tried to kill it 100-odd times, but the dog was always too smart for them. Finally, one of them got a coon's innards, and filled it up with gunpowder and tied a piece of punk in the nozzle. When he sees this dogger coming around, he fired this punk, split open a corn cake, and squoze the intestine inside, all nice and slab, and threw out the lot. The dog was always ravenous, and swallowed the heap, ka-chunk. Pretty soon, along came an explosion, so the man said. The head of the animal lit on the stoop. The forelegs caught a straddle off the fence. The hind legs kicked in the ditch, and the rest of the critter lay around loose. Pretty soon, who should come along but Bill, and he was looking for his dog when he heard the supposed gun go off. The neighbour said innocent-like, "William, I guess that there is not much of that dog left to catch anybody's fowls." "Well, no," admitted Sykes. "I see plenty of pieces, but I guess that dog, as a dog, ain't of much account." "Just so, Medill, there may be fragments of Hood's army around, but I guess that army, as an army, ain't of much more account." Joseph Medill was editor of the Chicago Tribune, who was one of the coterie who claimed to have discovered Abraham Lincoln, and surely added propulsion to the wave carrying him to Washington. Another version of this anecdote is applied to the breaking up of General Early's rashly advanced army in July, but it would seem, by Mr. Medill's name, that this is the genuine. The other is not told in the Western vernacular of Mr. William Sykes. End of section 353. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 354 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, The Meteorological Omen, read for LibriVox.org. The second inauguration day was amid the usual March weather in the District of Columbia, like the fickle April in unkinder latitudes, smile and scowl. But as the President kissed the book, there was a sudden parting of the clouds, and a sunburst broke in all its splendor. This is testified to by the newspaper correspondents, Frank Moore, Noah Brooks, and others. The President said next day, "Did you notice the sunburst? It made me jump." End of section 354. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 355 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Did She Take the Wink to Herself? Miss Anna Dickinson, lecturing by invitation in the House of Representatives Hall, alluded to the sunburst which came upon the President on Inauguration Day, just as he took the oath of office. The illustrious auditor sat directly in front of the lady, so that he also faced the reporters' gallery behind her. Lincoln amiably glanced over her head, caught sight of an acquaintance among the newspaper men, and winked to him as she made the reference to the so-esteemed omen. Next day he said to this gentleman, Noah Brooks, "I wonder if Miss Dickinson saw me wink at you." End of section 355. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 356 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams, Going Down with Colors Flying, read for LibriVox.org by Cagliostro. All the wire pulling of the many contestants for the presidential chair failed to get a prize upon it. It was held that there must be, in excelsis, no swapping of horses in crossing the stream, still turbid and dangerous. So the National Convention, held at Baltimore, purged by this time of its former treasonable activity, and the Soldiers' Fair, held there, the President had alluded to the time when he had to be whisked through as past a bed of vipers, and said, "Blessings on the men who have wrought these changes." All the states voted for the incumbent save Missouri, which stood for the General Grant, but the votes transferred to Lincoln. The opinion was unanimous. Within 2 months he was driven by circumstances to call out 500,000 men. His partisans regretted the necessity, and on the old story that the people were tired of the war, declared it would prove injurious to his re-election. But it is undisputed that about half the levies never reached their mustering point. The artisan wells of the marplots were equalled only by the prodigality and persistency of the parents to save their sons from the evils of camp life. It is but fair that to the Puritans to accept their plea that the loss of them fighting the country's battle did not so distress them. Lincoln replied to the political argument nobly. "Gentlemen, it is not necessary that I should be re-elected, but it is necessary that our brave boys in the front should be supported and the country saved." The hackneyed phrase had led to his party being nicknamed the Union Saver. "I shall call out the 500,000 more men, and if I go down under the measure, I will go down like the Cumberland, with my colours flying." On the 8th of March, 1862, the Confederate ironclad ram Merrimack ran into and sank the Union sloop of war, Cumberland, nearly half of the latter's company perishing. Acting Captain Morris refused to strike his flag. End of section 356. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 357 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. There Must Be the Bell Mule. Read for LibriVox.org. President Lincoln formally disavowed the desire earnestly attributed to him by military critics that he wished to die with soldier's harness on his back. To quote General Grant, to whom he said in their first interview, when the victor of the West was summoned to Washington to be made lieutenant general and given full command over all the national forces, "Mr. Lincoln stated to me that he had never professed to be a military man or to know how campaigns should be conducted, and never wanted to interfere with them, but that procrastination on the part of his commanders and the pressure of people at the North and of Congress had forced him into issuing the executive orders. He did not know but that they were all wrong, and did not know that some of them were." End of section 357. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 358 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Root Hog or Die. Read for LibriVox.org by Jennifer 13, Chicago, Illinois. Root Hog or Die. In February 1865, permission was requested from the national government for three appointees on a peace commission to confer with the executive. It was granted, but the parties were not allowed to enter Washington as they wanted to do, to give more luster to the course. The interview of the president, Mr. Seward the bottle holder, as it was facetiously said about this sparring match for breath, was with Alexander Stevens, Hunter, and Campbell of Alabama, on board of the River Queen off Fort Monroe. The discussion lasted 4 hours, but, though on friendly terms as between gentlemen, resulted in nothing, for the President held that the first step which must be taken was the recognition of the Union. As was his habit, he rounded off the parley with one of his stories apropos. Mr. Hunter, a Virginian, had assumed that, if the South consented to peace on the basis of the Emancipation Proclamation, the slaves would precipitate ruin on not only themselves but the entire Southern society. Mr. Lincoln said to Henry J. Raymond of the Times, New York, that, "I waited for Seward to answer that argument, but, as he was silent, I at length said, 'Mr. Hunter, you ought to know a great deal better about that than I, for you have always lived under the slave system. I can only say in reply to your statement of the case that it reminds me of a man out in Illinois by the name of Case, who undertook to raise a very large herd of hogs. It was a great trouble to feed them, and how to get around this was a puzzle to him. At length he hit upon a plan of planting a great field of potatoes, and, when they were sufficiently grown, turn the whole herd into the field and let them have full swing, thus saving not only the labor of feeding the hogs, but also that of digging the potatoes. Charmed with his sagacity, he stood one day leaning against the fence, counting his hogs, when a neighbor came along. 'Well, well,' said he, 'this is all very fine, Mr. Case. Your hogs are doing very well just now. But, you know, out here in Illinois, the frost comes early, and the ground freezes for a foot deep. Then what are you going to do?'
This was a view of the matter Mr. Case had not taken into account. Butchering time for hogs was way on in December or January. He scratched his head, and at length stammered, "Well, it may come pretty hard on their snouts, but I don't see but it will be root-hog or die." The speaker had no need to draw this moral as to the fate of the South after the war, for black or white, from a case in Illinois. The Negro minstrel song was current then, which supplied the apt allusion, and was called Root-Hog or Die. It may well be that the sailors conveying the baffled commissioners to Richmond, or the soldiers about the other government, were chanting the instructive and prophetic chorus, "It don't make a bit of difference to either you or I, but big pig or little pig, it is root-hog or die." Mr. Raymond, in chronicling this anecdote, tells of the New York Herald giving the story in a mangled and pointless copy, but it was current in conversation. Mr. Lincoln was in hopes that it would not leak out lest some oversensitive people should imagine there was a degree of levity in the intercourse between us. Quite otherwise, for the majority thought the illustration as good as any argument, and would have deemed the speaker prophet if they could have foreseen that the South would have to buckle down to hard work to redeem the losses. End of Section 358. This recording is in the public domain. Recording by Jennifer 13, Chicago, Illinois.
Section 357 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Grant Brand of Whiskey. Read for LibriVox.org. Although a Kentuckian, Orthodox jest, Lincoln was so known for his rare temperance convictions that no one carped at the buffet at his official house, being clear of the decanters characterizing it in previous administrations. The total abstinence societies therefore hailed him as an apostle of their creed. Consequently, they had been pleased, on certain occasions, at his espousing and cheering their counsel. When General Grant was elevating himself by his string of solid victories in the West, it was an object of cavilling, by the adherents of the generals eclipsed and foreseeing his becoming lieutenant-general, and the slander circulated that Philip Sober got the credit of Philip Drunk, perpetrating his plans with the dram-bottle at his elbow. Lincoln heard out this spiteful diatribe with his habitual patience, when, calmly looking at the chairman, he responded, "Gentlemen, since you are so familiar with the general's habits, would you oblige me with the name of General Grant's favorite brand of whiskey? I want so to send some barrels of it to my other generals." The deputation withdrew in poor order. Major Eckert says that Mr. Lincoln told him he had heard this story. It was good, and would be very good if he had told it, but he had not. He supposed it was charged to him to give it currency. He went on to say, "The original is back in King George's time. Bitter complaints were made against General Wolfe that he was mad. The king, who could be more justly accused of that, replied, 'I wish he would bite some of my other generals.'" End of Section 359. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 360 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. A General at Last. Without disparaging the Lincoln generals, it may be said that they will never occupy a niche in Walhalla besides Napoleon's marshals and Washington's commanders. But Washington society liked them one with another for affording opportunities of outings to the grand reviews and parades. One, that to Bull Run, turned out a failure, and the Southerners chasing the fugitives had the pickings of the iced wines, game pies, and cold chicken, which Brick Pomeroy saw strewing the road back. Grant's negligent and war-worn uniform did not remind anyone of the gay and brilliant period of Old Fuss and Feathers, the veteran Scott. But Grant and the other Westerner, Lincoln, mutually pleased at their first meeting, the latter emerged from the interview exclaiming with joy, "At last we have a general!" End of Section 360. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 361 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. A Fizzle Anyhow. Read for LibriVox.org by Cagliostro. American Dash was, in military matters as in others, opposed to the engineering schemes dear to the scientific officers fresh from West Point Academy. Among their projects was the Dutch Gap Canal at City Point. When Grant, as his lieutenant general, was conducted by the president to see the forces and their positions, the guide made known his opinion of the undertaking in his frank manner, consonant with the new commander's bluntness. Grant, do you know what this reminds me of? In the outskirts of our Springfield, there was a blacksmith of an ingenious turn who could make something of pretty nigh anything in his line. But he got hold of a bit of iron one day that he attempted to make into a corn knife. But the stuff would not hold an edge, so he reasoned it would be a claw hammer. But that would be a loss of overplus, and he tried to make an axe head. That did not come out a five-pounder, and, getting disgusted, he blew the fire to a white heat around the metal mass, when, yanking it out with his tongs, he flung it into the water tub hard by and cried out, "Well, if I can't make anything of you, I'll make a fizzle anyhow." Well, General, I am afeard that that's what we'll make of the Dutch Gap Canal. End of section 361. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 362 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Forget Over a Grave. Read for LibriVox.org. When the Chronicle of Washington had the noble courage to speak well of Stonewall Jackson, accidentally shot as a brave soldier, however mistaken as an American, Lincoln wrote to the editor, "I honor you for your generosity to one who, though contending against us in a guilty cause, was nevertheless a gallant man. Let us forget his sins over a fresh-made grave." End of section 362. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 363 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. If he felt that way, start. Read for LibriVox.org by David Lawrence. If he felt that way, start. Although Colonel Dana, of the private branch of the War Office Intelligence Department, might have claimed exemption from active service, he never spared himself, though such a messenger ran not only the common military dangers, but of the Johnnies treating him as a spy. During the battles of the Wilderness, acute was a trepidation in Washington, where no news had come since a couple of days, Grant having cut loose and buried himself in the midst of the foes. Nevertheless, Dana had a train at Maryland Avenue to take him to the front, and a horse and escort to see him farther. He came to take the President's last orders, but the other had been reflecting on the perils into which he would be sending his favorite dispatch-bearer. You can't tell where Lee is or what he is doing. Jeb Stuart is on the rampage pretty lively between the Rappahannock and the Rapidan. It is considerable risk, and I do not like to expose you to it. But I am ready, and we are equipped, if it comes to the worst, to run. Well now, if you feel that way, start. E. P. Mitchell, from Dana. End of section 363. This recording is in the public domain. Recording by David Lawrence, December 29, 2008, in Brampton, Ontario.
Section 364 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Figures Will Prove Anything. Read for LibriVox.org by Morgan Dowdrick. Figures Will Prove Anything. Towards the finish of the rebellion, Lincoln was asked to what number the enemy might amount. He replied with singular readiness, "The Confederates have 1,200,000 men in the field." Astonishment being manifested at the precision, he went on, smiling, "Every time a Union commander gets licked, he says the enemy outnumbered him 3 or 4 times. We have 300,000 or 400,000, so logic is logic. They are three times that, say 1,200,000. As a fact, at the Grand Review before President Johnson, the two armies of Grant and Sherman, May 1865, 200,000 veterans filed past. Lincoln should have lived to see that glorious march past. End of Section 364. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 365 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. I don't want to, but that's it if I must die. In the ferment, as the term of Lincoln's first office holding was terminating, the old war fever returned by which little Mac McClellan, idol of the army, was hailed as the hope of the country. Only this time the presage was that General Grant had only to secure that phantasm, the capture of Richmond, to be nominated and elected. This reached the President's ears through the hanged good-natured friend, as Sheridan, the wit, not the general, calls the stinging tongue. "Well," drawled Mr. Lincoln, "I feel very much like the man who said he did not particularly want to die, but if he had got to die, it was precisely the disease he wanted to die of." End of Section 365. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 366 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Best Let an Elephant Go. Read for LibriVox.org by David Lawrence. Best Let an Elephant Go. A rebel emissary, the notorious Jacob Thompson, was reported by the Secret Service as slipping through the North and trying to get passage to Europe on the Allen steamship out of Portland, Maine, or Canada. Brevet General Dana, confidential officer to the War Department and the President, inquired if the fugitive was to be detained at Portland, where the Provost Marshal thought he could capture him. Secretary Stanton wanted him apprehended. Said Lincoln, who was being shaved, "I don't know as I have any apprehension in that quarter. When you have an elephant on your hands, and he wants to run away, better let him run." Note, the unbeknownst story has been applied to this tolerated escape. End of Section 366. This recording is in the public domain. Recording by David Lawrence in Brampton, Ontario, December 29th, 2008.
Section 367 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. History Repeats. Read for LibriVox.org. There is a double echo in the Lincolnian saying, "No surrender, though at the end of 100 defeats," from General President Taylor's reply at Buena Vista, "General Taylor never surrenders," to its antecedent, not so well authenticated, of General Cambronne at Waterloo, "The old guard dies, but does not surrender." End of Section 367. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 368 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Not the President, but the Old Friend. Read for LibriVox.org by Cagliostro. In February 1865, General Grant's plans were so well shaped that, with the reinforcement of General Sherman, returned from his march to Savannah, he could count on crushing up Richmond as an egg under trip hammers. Before this, the doom was registered, for the Southerners were at the end of their men, as before they had been at that of their means. Bridges burned or blown up, the rebel army was pouring out of their capital with the fear that their one or two ways of flight were already blocked by Sheridan or Sherman. The desperate attempt to arm slaves against their coming deliverer was the last kick. Lee clung to Richmond in hope that his lieutenant, Johnston, would check the oncomer, but he was compelled to notify his President and colleagues that flights were their only resource when he could no longer fight. Lincoln was at Petersburg, at Grant's headquarters, when, a few miles off, Davis received fatal intelligence that Lee was being deserted so freely that there would not be a bodyguard left him. He fled to be ignominiously captured in female disguise. His lair was hot when Lincoln entered it and made it his closet, whence he issued his orders. Soon after this occupation, the victor heard the name of Pickett announced to him. The Southern general, George Pickett, was a protege of his. As he smoothed his entry upon the West Point Military Academy book when he was a congressman. Without either knowing it, the hero was lying dead on a hard-fought field close by. But Lincoln ordered her admittance. She was accompanied by her little son. This alone would have prevailed over the president, but, as she formally addressed him as the authority, he interrupted. "Not the President, but George's old friend." And beckoning the wandering boy to him, with the irresistible attraction of men who love the young, and are intuitively loved by them, he said, "Tell your father, rascal, that I forgive him for the sake of your mother's smile and your own bright eyes." This reconciliation, on the fall of this word, was a token of the forgivingness of the North toward the Charleston foes. End of section 368. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 369 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Close Your Eyes. Read for LibriVox.org by Magdalena Cook. Close Your Eyes. The Marquis of Chambrun, a French volunteer who entered the Lincoln Circle, relates in a more elegant strain the above incident. He states that Thompson and Sanders were informed upon, and Stanton repeated the information to the President with a view of having them intercepted, but the other in his tender voice responded, "Let us close our eyes and leave them pass unnoticed." End of section 369. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 370 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Don't judge by appearances. The President's recklessness seems incredible as to going about the Capitol, as far as he knew and wished, without escort, but his browsing, to use his word, about the perilous front while the concluding actions were enveloping Petersburg preliminarily to the rush at Richmond, partake of the nature of a fanatic's daring. This is the support to the otherwise taxing story told by Dr. J. E. Burris of New York, then a volunteer soldier at the place. He states that Lincoln, so shabbily dressed as to be taken for a farmer or a planter, was so treated by soldiery before a tobacco warehouse under guard. They wanted tobacco and begged him to allow some to be turned out. He approached a young lieutenant commanding the post, but the latter was insolent to the old Southerner. The latter sent a soldier to General Grant, who himself rode up, post-haste, at the summons. The soldiers were given some of the Indian weed, and the donor, turning to the impertinent officer, who had thought him a converted Reb, said, "Young sir, do not judge by appearances, and for the future treat your elders with more respect." End of section 370. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 371 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Nothing can touch him further. Read for LibriVox.org by Hannah Dowell. Returning to Washington from Richmond, Lincoln read twice to friends on the journey from his pocket Shakespeare. Treason has done his worst. Nor steel, nor poison, malice domestic, foreign levy, nothing can touch him further. End of section 371. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 372 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Went and Returned. Read for LibriVox.org. On the last days of March, 1865, contained the three battles, closing with that of Five Forks, signalizing the collapse of the Confederacy at Richmond. The President at the front sent the news of victories to the Cabinet at home. After the battles, the advance of the triumphing Unionists. On Monday morning, Lincoln was unable to telegraph the talismanic words so often dreamed of in the last agonizing years of fluctuating hope. "Richmond has fallen. I am about to enter." Secretary Staunton of the War Office immediately implored, "Do not peril your life." But in the morning he received this line from the most independent president known since Jackson. "Received your dispatch. Went to Richmond and returned this morning." Expostulated with by Speaker Colfax on the apparent rashness, for he had completed the foolhardy act by occupying President Jefferson Davis's vacated house, he replied with the calm of a man of destiny, "I should have been alarmed myself if any other person had been president and gone there, but I did not feel in any danger whatever." Note. Mark the analogy in great men. General Grant says of his first emotions in war, the Mexican, "If someone else had been colonel and I had been lieutenant colonel, I do not think I would have felt any trepidation." End of section 372. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 373 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Clear Foresight. Read for LibriVox.org. The Clear Foresight. On the 2nd of April, 1865, the President was at City Point, Grant's headquarters, until he started forth for the culminating series of ceaseless strokes. That morning, attack along the whole line had been commanded, and the President telegraphed to his wife at the Capitol during the raging battle. He knew that already the hostile lines had been pierced in one or more places, and that Sheridan's cavalry rush was supported by a division of infantry. He concludes foreseeing that at length pegging away was over and slugging begun. All is now favorable. In truth, on that same day, the rebel government at Richmond faded thence like a mirage, and within 1 week General Lee surrendered his enfeebled relic of a grand army. End of section 373. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 374 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Do It Unbeknownst. Read for LibriVox.org by Hannah Dowell. On April 7th, 1865, General Grant had enveloped the enemy so that he could be assured that the rebel government, if it remained in Richmond as the last ditch, would be trapped. He notified the President close by at Petersburg and asked what should be done in the event of the game being bagged. The plan was, it seems, to have slain the ex-President and his cabinet officers in a rout, and the charge had been described as massacre abroad. The arbiter on this point of anguish replied in his characteristic manner, "I will tell you a story. There was once an Irishman who signed the Father Matthew's temperance pledge, but a few days afterward he became terribly thirsty and finally went into a familiar resort, where the barkeeper was, at first, startled to hear him call for a straight soda. He related that he had taken the pledge, so he hinted, with an Irishman's broadness of hint, 'You might put in some spirits, unbeknownst to me.'" Note, another and later version, for the above was limitedly repeated at the time with gusto and appreciation of the subtlety, makes the hero a temperance lecturer at Lincoln's father's house. This is stupid, for Lincoln, a fervent temperance advocate, would not have decried the apostles of the doctrine for which he was also a sufferer. In course of time, doubt has been cast on this anecdote, by reason that the President would not have jested at such a juncture. But abundant confirmation was forthcoming at the time. Besides, we have so grave a general as Sherman alluding to the unbeknownst in an official document. End of section 374. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 375 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. One Cannot Die Twice. In Lincoln's last interview with his rustic friends, Mrs. Armstrong repeated the fears many apprehended of evil being visited on the President-elect on his way to be inaugurated. "Hannah, if they do kill me, I shall never die another death," and laughed at her. End of Section 375. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 376 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. No More Invidious Name-Calling. Read for LibriVox.org. On returning from a carriage drive into Washington, Mrs. Lincoln, who was not the Southern sympathizer the scandalous hinted, glanced at the city and said aloud with bitterness, "That city is full of our enemies." Had she a premonition on the fatal eve? Right before the Marquis of Chambrun, their companion, the President serenely said, "Enemies, Mary, never speak of that." No wonder, when the dastardly taking off was bruited through the beaten but ever-gallant South, they knew that they had lost their best friend, as General Pickett styled Lincoln. By the Marquis of Chambrun. End of Section 376. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 377 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The United States of America, the Treasury of the World. Read for LibriVox.org. The United States of America, the Treasury of the World. As Schuyler Colfax was going west, Lincoln, in bidding him the last farewell, said foresightedly, "I have very large ideas of the mineral wealth of our nation. Now that the rebellion is overthrown, and we know pretty nearly the amount of our national debt, the more gold and silver we mine, we make the payment of that debt the easier. Tell the miners from me that I shall promote their interests to the best of my ability, because their prosperity is the prosperity of the nation, and we shall prove in a few years that we are the treasury of the world." End of Section 377. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 378 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Hang on, not hang. Read for LibriVox.org. On April 11th, 1865, Mr. Lincoln spoke out of his study window to an immense and joyous crowd. There were rockets and port fire and a huge bonfire while the President was serenaded. The finish of the rebellion delighted all persons. His offhand speech was full of compassion and brotherly love. Louisiana was already being reconstructed. Mr. Harlan, who followed the chief, touched the major key. "What shall we do with the rebels?" To which the mob responded hoarsely, "Hang them!" Lincoln's little son, Tad, was in the room, playing with the quills on the table where his father made his notes. He looked at his father and said, as one whose intimacy made him familiar with his inmost thoughts, "No, Papa, not hang them, but hang on to them." The President triumphantly repeated, "We must hang on to them. Tad's got it." By Mrs. H. McCullough, present. End of Section 378. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 379 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Lincoln's Last Wish. Read for LibriVox.org. Lincoln's Last Wish. Springfield, how happy 4 years hence will I be to return there in peace and tranquillity. To the Marquis of Chambrun, April, 1865. End of Section 379. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 380 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Assassination. At Springfield, immediately upon the election for President, Lincoln began to receive letters with lethal menaces. His friends took them as serious, and two or more carried weapons and escorted him closely that no one with the dagger might reach his side. Calling on his stepmother for the farewell, she reiterated the general and rising fears. At Philadelphia, detectives and others whispered of a plot matured at Baltimore, and in his speech at raising the flag over Independence Hall he said pointedly, "If this country cannot be saved without giving up this principle, liberty to the world, I was about to say I would rather be assassinated on the spot than surrender it. I have said nothing but what I am willing to live by, and, if it be the pleasure of Almighty God, to die by." Speech, Philadelphia, February, 1861. End of Section 380. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 381 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. A President, Not an Emperor. Read for LibriVox.org by Christine. A President, Not an Emperor. The President said to Colonel Halpin, as respected the lifeguards, which he soon dispensed with around his person, often going out unawares so as to dodge the escort in waiting, "It will never do for the President of a Republic to have guards with drawn swords at his door, as if he fancied he were, or were trying to be, or were assuming to be an emperor." End of Section 381. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 382 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Plot to Waylay the President, 1860. Read for LibriVox.org by Steve Eberhardt. The dispute as to whether there was a foundation to the supposed plot to waylay and sequester President-elect Lincoln between Philadelphia and Washington is notable. From the later light and a letter from Wilkes Booth to his brother-in-law, Sleeper Clark, the comedian, no doubt is left that to kidnap him was a plot dated very early, when the four-sided slaveholders were certain that he was a greater enemy from consistency than the louder-voiced and openly violent abolitionists. While Colonel Lamon doubted and wished he had not been beguiled into aiding the ignominious flight in disguise and secretly by train, Secretary Seward and General Scott gave it credence. The foreboding had touched Lincoln before he left his Illinois home. At Springfield, his farewell speech is tinged with shade. At Philadelphia and Harrisburg, he spoke of blood spilling and used the word assassination at the former. He took up the matter like a reasoner. Already the detective brothers, Pinkerton, had an inkling of the doings of the Knights of the Golden Circle, or some such secret society, designing regicide. So, as the concordance is held as a proof from the variance of the witnesses to scenes, he argued that the story was founded. Otherwise, he would not have heard of the criminal attempt from all sides. That was what made him yield his dignity to the safety of a person whom he felt was chosen for the crisis. The next morning, he had concluded to pass through Baltimore at another than the arranged hour to foil the plot. End of Section 382. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 383 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. I Don't Believe There Is Any Danger. Read for LibriVox.org by Christine. I Don't Believe There Is Any Danger. One night the President had been very late with the Secretary of War at the Letters Department, but just the same he insisted on his getting home by the shortcut, a footpath lined and embowered by trees, then leading from the War Office to the White House. But Stanton stopped him. "You ought not to go that way. It's dangerous for you in the daytime." It did lend itself to an ambuscade, and persons who knew Wilkes Booth assert, having seen him prowling around, "It's worse at night." "I do not believe there is any danger there, night or day," responded the President, with Malcolm's confidence that he stood in the great hand of God. "Well, Mr. President," continued Stanton, a stubborn man himself, "you shall not be killed returning from my department by that dark way while I am in it. And he forced him to enter his carriage to return by the well-lighted avenue. Lincoln had previously consented to carry a cane. End of section 383. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 384 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Worry Till You Get Rid of Things. Read for LibriVox.org. On Colonel Halpine trying to make the chief see that even indoors there was danger, he debated about the two menaces, violence of cranks and of a political fanatic. He thought too well of the sense of the people at Richmond, some of whom had been colleagues of his in his first stay at Washington as congressman. Do you think they would like to have Hannibal Hamlin, his first vice-president, here any better than myself? The story is repeated with his second vice substituted for the first, with the more justification, as Andy Johnson was impeached for his incompetency. Detective Baker put it this way, "As to the crazy folks, I must take my chances, the most crazy people being, I fear, some of my own too zealous adherents." He had the same idea as in an ancient Chinese proverb, "You may steal the captain out of his castle, but you cannot steal the castle." I am but a single individual, and it would not help their cause, or make the least difference in the progress of the war. Footnote. He might have said, as truly as his predecessor, John Tyler, reproached also for going about unguarded, "My bodyguard is the people who elected me." Cited by F. B. Carpenter. End of section 384. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 385 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Fearlessness of the God-Fearing. Read for LibriVox.org by Christine. The Fearlessness of the God-Fearing. Lincoln said that by the death of his son Willie he was touched, by the victory of Gettysburg made a believer. It is plain that, after this, a fortitude replaced the despondency stamping him. It may be due to this conviction of being one of the chosen, like Cromwell and Gordon, soldiers of Christ, that he met all adjurations for him to take care of his precious life with fanatical unconcern. He communicated to the cabinet, at the close of the conflict, how he had appointed to confer alone and without guards to terrify the emissary, a noted Confederate. They were to discuss peace, and by that word Lincoln was drawn to anyone. He answered the cautions with a simple saying, "I am but an individual, and my removal will not in any way advance the other folks in their endeavors." In fact, it was so. The misdeed was a double-edged blade which cut both ways. It will never be known, probably, how near a massacre followed the explosion of indignation at that maniac's murder of the Emancipator. Fortunately, for the unsullied robe of Columbia, 100 advocates of leaving retribution to heaven echoed Garfield's appeasing address. Lincoln met the intermediator, but the ultimate negotiation fell through, like the others all. He came home from City Point with sadness, but from his seat his outcome the Universal Peace Tribunal of The Hague. Professor Martens based his original plea of the Tsars on the Lincolnian Guide for the Soldiers in Our War. End of section 385. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 386 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The Poisoning Plot. A servant at the White House testifies that he was approached by emissaries who offered him a sum almost preposterously large to put a powder in the milk for the Lincoln's family table. The agents knew that they were temperance followers, milk being as common as wine at previous tenants' table. This was laughed at before the shadow of Booth's patricide was cast ahead. But the Reverend Henry Ward Beecher publicly declares, and he was in the state secrets as deeply as any layman, that President General Harrison, Tippecanoe, was poisoned that Tyler might fulfill the plan to annex Texas as a slave state.
With even stronger convictions is it affirmed that President General Taylor was poisoned, that a less stern successor might give a suppler instrument to manage. Who doubts now that it was attempted Breckinridge in his room? End of section 386. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 387 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Nothing like getting used to things. Read for LibriVox.org. Nothing like getting used to things. The more evident it grew that the President, at whom the stupid jeers persisted through incurable density of his enemies, was the vital motor of the Union cause, than threats of violently removing him were continually sent him. So many such letters accumulated that he grimly packeted them together and labeled them as assassination papers. It was a Damoclesian dagger, of which he spoke lightly, because fear of death never awed him. When a man walks in the manifest path, traced out for him by heaven, he does not tremble. But friends, more concerned by the strain in watching over his safety, expressing surprise at his indifference, he tried to reassure them. Oh, there is nothing like getting used to things. End of section 387. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 388 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Most Afraid of a Friendly Shot. Read for LibriVox.org. General Wadsworth, in his anxiety about the President's safety in Washington, swarming with insurgent agents, set a cavalry guard over the President's carriage. He went and complained to General Halleck, in charge of the Capitol, saying only partly facetiously, "Why, Mrs. Lincoln and I cannot hear ourselves talk for the clatter of their sabers and spurs, and some of them appear to be new hands and very awkward, so that I am afraid of being shot by the accidental discharge of a carbine or revolver than any attempt upon my life by a roving squad of Jeb Stuart's cavalry." Since Stuart came 20 miles within the Union lines, he was the criterion of rebel raiders' possibilities. End of section 388. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 389 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. The One Word He Had Learned. Read for LibriVox.org. The One Word He Had Learned. A talebearer came to the President with a plot against him and the government, which was a cock and bull without any adherence, and all superficial. Lincoln heard him out, but then sharply returned. "There is one thing that I have learned, and that you have not. It's only one word, sorrow." Then bringing his huge hand down on the table desk, to emphasize his meaning, he repeated, "Sorrow." End of section 389. This recording is in the public domain.
Section number 390 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Not to Disappoint the People. Read for LibriVox.org by Bill Elliott at Vocability.com. The strictly religious went so far as to call the Lincoln assassination a judgment, as it happened in a playhouse on a Good Friday. It appears that the President had compunctions, and at the last minute was disinclined to go, though a party had been made up to oblige a young espoused couple. But General Grant, who was to be a feature of the command performance, was called away, no doubt escaping the knife the murderer had in reserve to his pistol. The President said that he must go, not to disappoint the people on this gala night, as the rejoicing was wide over the dissolution of the Confederacy. End of section number 390. This recording is in the public domain.
Section 391 of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. Nothing like prayer but praise. Read for LibriVox.org by Esther. Nothing like prayer but praise. In 1862, the President suffered an affliction harder to bear than the war. His son Willie, William, next to the one that died in infancy, was carried off by typhoid fever under the presidential roof, and another, Tad, Thomas, who actually lived to be 20 and passed away in Illinois, was given up by the physicians. At this crisis, Miss Dix, daughter of the general, famous for his order, "If anyone offers to pull down the American flag, shoot him on the spot," recommended an army nurse, Mrs. Rebecca R. Pomeroy. She was a born succorer, pious and fortifying. She came reluctantly to the important errand, as she had to leave a wardful of wounded soldiers. She had lost many of her family, and was able to comfort from gauging the affectionate father's grief. She led him to pray in his double racking of bad war news and the domestic distress. On next seeing him, and that he was less grieved, for news of the Fort Donelson surrender to General Grant arrived in the meantime, she hastened to say, "There is nothing like prayer, Mr. President." "Yes, there is. Praise. Prayer and praise must go together." The end. End of section 391. End of the Lincoln Storybook by Henry L. Williams. This recording is in the public domain.